I talked to the president last week.
Oh, you got calls too? We were smoking. Oh, you
Mark?
I didn't get calls.
Yes.
Good evening. Welcome to our regular scheduled meeting of the Town Council of March 20th, 2017. Deputy, if you could lead us in the front. Dolores.
Councilor Bello.
Here.
Councilor Hammond.
Here.
Councilor Hurley.
Here.
Councilor Latina.
Here.
Councilor Martino.
Here.
Councilor Rell.
Here.
Councilor Spinella.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Barry.
Here.
And Mayor Montanari.
Here. Thank you, Dolores. Our first order of business this evening is a presentation by our esteemed superintendent of schools and his team. So it's all yours, Mike. Thank you for being here.
Hello, everyone, and happy spring.
I would just go down and chop it. Who cares who they are? All right. You can't lock them.
Good evening, Mayor, members of Town Council, Town Manager Bridges. Very pleased to be with you this evening to present the board-approved proposed education for the Weathersfield Public Schools for the fiscal year 2017-2018.
Okay, the Board of Ed held a public budget workshop on Saturday, January 28th, and the board members also went to speak to the PTOs in town. And what we were looking for was to explain this budget to them. We want the public to know where their money is going and to get citizens' input. We also communicated our pride in the Weathersfield students by improving by one of the highest percentages in the state on the SBAC. Our students are becoming more computer savvy, and on the Connecticut Accountability Index, Hamner School was recognized as a school of distinction. The budget investment in our school shows in every student succeeding.
So we'll get right to the numbers. Our approved 16-17 budget was $56,613,100. We're proposing for the 17-18 fiscal year a budget of $58,277,882. That is an increase of $1,664,782. This represents a percentage increase of 2.94% over the current budget.
And what does the increase include? It's contractual obligations, benefit requirements, state and federal mandates, actuarial defined cost of OPEB, trust and pension, and fixed costs, which are transportation, tuition, and utilities. Okay, I did want to say something. 98.5% of our budget is non-discretionary, which leaves so little for innovation and new initiatives.
Here's a breakdown of budget by object. This is very consistent with school districts across the state. The vast majority of our budget goes for salaries and benefits. So you can see a breakdown.
And here's our budget by major programs. I won't read it to you. You can look at it and see. Our instructional programs take up the largest piece of the pie. And it goes right around, and I know some people here will be disappointed to see that athletics is at the smallest sliver, but that's our budget by programs.
Just to give you an idea, over the past several years, you can see the Weathersfield Public Schools, what our increases have been. The 2012-13, you'll notice that we increased $2,008,940. That was the implementation of full-day kindergarten. And when you take a look at our performance on the SBAC this past year, I'd have to say that full-day kindergarten was a rousing success. Those kids that came in at that point in time were kids that actually took the Smarter Balanced Assessment. As Mrs. Granato said, Weathersfield was fortunate to have among the highest rates of growth in the entire state of Connecticut. Reading, grades 3 through 8 on the SBAC, we increased a little over 10%. And in math, our district increased grades 3 through 8, 13% over the previous year's test results. What you'll notice also in the 16-17 budget year, as you may recall, we had money left in our budget last year, about $500,000. We returned that to the town, so you see the decrease there in the amount funded to the Board of Education last year.
Okay, again, I won't read this all to you, but these are requests not included in the budget. And the special ed teacher not included was a teacher teacher trained in the Orton-Gillingham method for teaching students with dyslexia. And an ELL, which is English language learner teacher, was also not included. Our ELL student population is growing rapidly, and these students need this ELL support to be successful in school.
Additional requests not included in the budget. These are priorities through the discussion with all of our principals. Looking at a 0.5 social worker at the middle school level to accommodate the increased needs for students on social emotional issues. Part-time edgenuity tutor at the high school. Part-time athletic director stipend. We have one athletic director who also doubles as an assistant principal. Again, world language teacher with dual language certification to meet new graduation requirements. One of the things we did with our 21st century high school is we increased our expectations for graduation for the class beginning in class of 2020, rather. So we're going to need to address this. This is not in this year's budget proposal for next year, but it is something we need to look at for the future.
Okay, further requests not included in the budget from the district and the Board of Education requests, and I won't read them all to you. You can read them. But the $175,000 for curriculum enhancement, believe it or not, I'm not as concerned with the deletion of textbooks. But if you look further down at our $400,000 not included in the technology budget, this does hinder us from reaching our goal of one-to-one, where each student has a personal handheld device. That is an indicator of a 21st century system. The lacrosse program will be a club program next year, and that is a great example of everyone working together for our student athletes.
Okay. So the estimated cost of unfunded requests are to the tune of $1,730,803. We've not included any of these requests in the proposed budget. This is the breakdown again. Sorry for the font and the type size, but this is a breakdown of what our salaries look like. And you can see overall in this area for personal services salaries, this is a 3.16% increase. So these are contractual obligations. One of the things I want to point out to you that this budget includes the shift of a 0.9 FTE equivalent teacher from the IDEA grant due to reduced funding from the federal government. And we've also had to shift over two paras from IDEA, again, due to that funding decrease. Here's the benefit component. Again, the benefit component demonstrates a 7.41% increase over the current year. You'll notice that the benefits comprise 14.62% of our total budget. And we're seeing an increase. Our obligation for the OPEB trust is increasing $78,000. And again, we know at this point in time that there's going to be some flexibility with regard to the health insurance numbers. Here's our purchase professional and technical services. We're seeing a decrease in this line. This is an area that we're looking to reduce. Again, maintaining our programs and our staffing as whole, we're looking for other areas to reduce.
And here's our decrease of 0.37% or $3,830 due to deferring facility repairs and maintenance projects throughout the district. This includes reduction to security enhancement and district-wide painting. I know it sounds trite, but the buildings do get used. They don't get abused. They get used. And after a while, we really do need to spruce them up.
Not to mention we have the ongoing issues of maintenance and repairs. So today, for example, we learned that we need a new water heater at Silas Dean Middle School. And sad to say that the roof over at the Stillman Building has sprung a couple of holes again. We're dealing with leaks. So it is part of the reality in dealing with some buildings that are a little bit on in years. Okay. And here you have other purchased services. Again, we've really tried to hold the line on this one. So we're seeing a very small decrease of less than 1%. Again, this deals with transportation, field trips, licenses and fees. And again, you've also got the issue of special education. I've often said, as I've presented before you, that special education continues to be a volatile line. Some years we do well, other years, if we have someone that moves in that requires services beyond what we can provide in district, we're forced to move for an out-of-district placement.
Other purchase services, now read this, we're decreasing by 0.04% or $2,681 with the expectation that a reduction in special ed, we just talked about that, outplacements will offset the projected increase in magnet school tuition. And just an aside, I'm also on the CREC Council and they too are working on a tuition increase. This also includes an anticipated decreases in technical school transportation and tuition. Do this one? Okay, decreasing by 0.04% with the expectation reducing natural gas consumption will offset the majority of projected increases of electricity throughout the district. And this one is on. The new math for the middle school textbooks in 2016-17 budget.
One of the things to be aware of also, I want to bring to your attention, obviously the diesel and the natural gas. Those figures are figures that we work with as a collaborative. So those figures we think are pretty solid. One of the areas that we've struggled with this year has been electricity. And we are about $60,000 over where we were year over year with our current electricity budget. And I believe that, you know, one of the things that was perceived was when the high school opened with all of the LED lighting and all of the new, you know, energy efficient lighting that we have in that building, we would have seen a dramatic decrease. Well, it was interesting when we started to look at the analysis of the electricity use. It was interesting. We found that 25% of the energy, the electricity consumption at Weathersfield High School occurred on a weekend, which is really indicative of the amount of use that building has already gotten, not only from our own programs, such as athletic programs, but park and rec programs, outside activities as well. Okay. And then this one, each year, in terms of our instructional equipment and technology equipment, we've seen a decrease here. What we like to do on a yearly basis is we like to refurbish 2 classrooms per school. That fell out of this current year's budget. That is also not in next year's budget as well. And then with dues and fees, again, this is just a very small decrease.
Okay, I do want to read to you the budget outcomes. We remain committed to providing a high-quality education for all of our students. We remain focused on continuous improvement while adhering to state and federal mandates that impact our budget. We wish to build upon the progress we've made. We wish to maintain our commitment to learning for all our students, and we look to foster innovation throughout the district. And I want to make a mention of innovation. Innovation in this age of technology, the board and the administration often point out that this year's K class, kindergarten class, will graduate in 2029. And we ask the question quite often, how do we get them ready for their world? Well, it's an awesome responsibility, one that we take very seriously, and we think of it daily in our decision making. This board and administration is confident that with the town's support, we will have all of our students, from K to seniors, ready for their future.
In terms of our timeline, obviously we're here before you this evening presenting. We've got the townwide budget hearing on April 17th. And again, unlike previous years, this May 15th date is one that we're not quite as sure of. Obviously, we know by charter we're sure of it, but we've got a lot that we need to deal with from the state of Connecticut at this point in time. Certainly, we are aware of the fact that we have the potential with regard to the impact of teachers' retirement. That has the potential to impact our budget. Obviously, the special education fund has a potential. And in addition to that, Weathersfield is one of only 31 municipalities that actually sees an increase in ECS to the tune of about $985,000. Having had the opportunity to listen to Lieutenant Governor Nancy Wyman 2 weeks ago and speaking with Representative Morin as recently as today, we know that the budget from the state is far from etched in stone. We expect it to change. So we're certainly going to have to be cautious in terms of moving forward. But we believe wholeheartedly that this budget in this tight economic time is responsible. It serves to maintain the services that we have provided to our students. It serves to maintain our programs and to maintain our staff as whole. So with that, we'll entertain any questions you may have.
Thank you. Mike, I had a question.
By the charter, it says that you're supposed to present a budget. I know I go through this every year. That has prior year, the first prior year actuals, which you have, 2015-16, and then an estimate of the current year. But I only see budget in here mm-hmm. for the current year, and that's for receipts and expenses. So I'm not sure. Do you have that?
I will work with Mr. Kazak, our business manager, to make sure you get that.
Okay. With the same line items that are in here?
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
Anyone else?
Other questions from council?
What ECS funding assumption did you use?
We used the standard ECS funding, not the additional $985,000 coming from this governor's budget. We were extraordinarily cautious with the governor's budget. That's like the issue of the $2.8 million for teachers' retirement. And talking with Representative Morin today, that's something he doesn't, in his opinion, think is going to happen at this point in time. Again, I think, you know, Deputy Mayor Barry, we need to be extraordinarily cautious here. We know things are going to change. You know, talking with some of my colleagues that saw significant reductions in ECS dollars, West Hartford, for example, it's a lot of potential doom and gloom. You know, we're hopeful that we're able to maintain where we're at. And I have to say, I'm extraordinarily proud of the progress we've made. You know, at the beginning of the year when the scores came out, and you know, we don't look at one test score as the end-all be-all for our district. It's a combination of many things. But, you know, to be lauded by the state as we were for the rate of growth. And what's happened at this point in time is we are now hosting other districts coming into Weathersfield to see what we're doing. We have innovative curriculum. We have a new math curriculum. We've had three districts come in to look at our math curriculum and see what we're doing. So we're garnering some very positive support here within our fellow education community. So we're very proud of that.
Thank you. Michael. And, sure. And I just want to make a comment on that. I told you earlier that I'm on the CREC Council, and CREC is composed of 35 surrounding towns in the greater Hartford area. And the chairperson of CREC advised all of us to do what's best for our own town and for our own children, because the state was in such a, at that point, disarray. We seem to be coming out of it slowly. But we're taking that advice.
Mike, in
yes,
the
sir.
Governor's proposal he brought forward, he showed a new money fund coming in for special education.
Correct.
Which we were to get some money. How is that reflected in here, or is it not?
It is not at this point in time, Mr. Martino. It is not. And at this time, what we expect, that special education fund approximately is $4.7 million. That would end up eliminating the excess cost grant. That excess cost grant tends to bring in $1 million a year, which offsets tuition. So we're going to have to make that adjustment. And then you couple it with the 2.8 million dollars for teachers' retirement. That's another factor. You know, one of the things we were asking about with regard to the teachers' retirement that was not really clearly stated in the governor's budget is we have a lot of teachers that are teaching for CREC. Who covers the retirement for CREC? Would we share in that? I'm not sure that that $2.8 million encompasses that. So we were really cautious with regard to the governor's budget. There's a lot in it, and again, we've really tried to communicate with our elected officials at the state level. I am a member of the Hartford Area Superintendents Association, so there's a lot of discussion that goes on. And I must tell you, with some of these, as I mentioned, West Hartford, you know, they're talking about the potential of 200 layoffs. Heard from other superintendents talking about the elimination of full-day kindergarten. I mean, we really worked hard. It took us years to get full-day K, and we see by our test scores that full-day K has paid off. I mean, that's certainly the last thing I'd like to do. I'm also realistic, and we're looking at areas that we may need to reduce. We are certainly hopeful that you'll be supportive of the budget as it is at 2.94. We're also hopeful that in the event we can find additional savings, we'll have the opportunity to reinvest those savings back into that ELL teacher we need. Mrs. Granato talked about the English language learners. Met with the principal at Charles Wright today. 19% of our kindergartners at Charles Wright are English language learners. That is a huge number. And right now we've got two English language learner teachers for the entire district. So it's definitely a factor we have to take a look at. The other thing I'd like to make clear to you, this is something that we really can't do in a vacuum. As this process continues on and more goes into this state budget, I think it's going to be critically important that we continue to have an open line of communication. We're certainly looking to bring forward additional budget workshops. We certainly want to keep our parents informed. As Mrs. Granato mentioned, board members have been out to all the PTO meetings. To make sure that we're keeping our parents informed of what's going on. So I think that's going to be paramount that we do that among both governing bodies.
Well, once again, on that same special education fund,
mm-hmm.
Is that, I mean, because you're talking with the others on it, is that going to be like the ECS fund where there's going to be a minimum budget requirement? So if you get an increase in that, we have to automatically give an increase?
Yeah, right. That's a great question. Right now, I don't have a clear understanding of what the minimum budget requirement is going to look like at this point. There was some question as to where that special education fund would go. There was a back and forth of does it go to the town or does it go to the district? And Mrs. Fitzpatrick was able to contact OPM and got clarification that that special ed fund would go to the Board of Education.
Mike Rowe.
Thank you, Mike. Thank you, Bobby. I appreciate you guys and the hard work of the Board of Ed and the administration. The question about the teacher's retirement. The governor's proposal has it split, you know, 50% this year, you know, down the road, you know, the town's taking up the full 100%. Who would pay for that? Would it come from the town side or would that be board funds?
The way I understand it and the what I've heard thus far, it's coming from the Board of Ed.
Okay.
If I might, I heard the opposite, and you'll see it in the proposed budget on the town side next week.
Okay. Well,
that's clear. Well,
may need a little bit of clarification on that.
Absolutely. Call the governor in the morning.
Yeah, please.
To the town?
It is town. Okay.
For the special ed fund or retirement? Okay.
Where the town puts it is up to the town.
Right. Okay.
Okay.
Anything else? That?
A couple slides back, athletic transportation was cut by a third,
mm-hmm.
from 30,000 down to 20,000. What impact would that have? I mean, what was the justification for that?
Well, what we're certainly looking to do is trying to reduce costs. We have three athletic buses, and they're extraordinarily expensive to maintain. And it's interesting, our newest one is the most trouble-prone. So what we're looking to do is we're looking to contract out through the bus company. And so you all know we're currently looking at an RFP for transportation to begin July 1 of 2017 with potentially a different company. So we'll look to find
the
savings
district,
here.
For the whole
district, that's correct.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Mm-hmm. So that's what we're looking to see the savings on.
And if they can do that, they can include athletic.
Correct.
Okay.
Correct.
Thank you.
You're welcome, Mike.
Donna?
Just a question, Mr. Emmett,
sure.
In regards to teachers' retirements. I know it's early in the year still. Have you received or built in a number of certain number of retirements?
We've built in. That's a great question. We've built in 6 thus far.
Okay.
And you know the potential exists that we will see more.
Okay. Thank you.
You're welcome.
Go ahead, Mike Ruth.
I had one on the electricity.
Mm-hmm.
The high school is going to cost us an extra $100,000 a year. For it, it looks like.
For the high school, yeah, the way we're trending right now, yes.
And we have the engineer who designed it looking at that.
Okay. Because that seems a little odd.
It's, well, you're absolutely right. And when you looked at the usage, and let's take a look at this. You've got a situation where on the average weekend, that high school is being used starting at 6 in the morning until 6 at night. This coming weekend, we've got an outside group coming in, a regional music festival. So we've got 2 sessions, both I think at 1 and at 3:30. And that's going to have hundreds of parents and kids there. They're going to be encompassing the auditorium, the cafeteria, the choral room, the music room, as they prepare and they do the festival. So we've hosted the wrestling club. We've hosted multiple weekends of the Barracuda swim team. So that building is used a lot.
Thanks.
You're welcome.
Hi.
Hi, Jody.
Thank you so much for all the hard work. I do like to look at a budget in the sense of expenditures and revenues. Mm-hmm. Were there any opportunities for revenues?
Yeah, great question. We actually, with the implementation of our Weathersfield Transition Academy, we actually had our first tuition-bearing student this year. We are currently getting ready to actually market that program. So we're hopeful of being able to bring in another 1 to 3 additional tuitions from outside of Weathersfield. So that's a potential. We haven't realized that yet. Again, we're getting into that point where it's starting to become PPT season, where we're planning transitions for students for next year. So that's definitely a potential.
When you talked about all the use of electricity for all of these extracurricular things that are happening at the school, how does that work right now if a group wants to come in and use the auditorium or use the gym? Are outside people charged? How does it work?
Outside groups are charged. PTO groups are not, and student groups are not. Park and Rec groups are not. Park and Rec pays a flat fee of $20,000. And I'll be the first to stand here and tell you it doesn't cover all of the use of the buildings. It's a reality. But any outside group, like an outside dance troupe, along those lines, those folks are charged for the use of the building.
And have those fees or rates, if you will, been looked at over the last 3 years?
Actually, the Policy and Planning Committee this year took a look at that and raised them. We figured raising them, given the fact that we have the state-of-the-art high school, it was time. So, yes, those numbers actually have gone up.
Thank you.
I had a follow-up question to that. On the revenue section, it shows from on the facilities rental, I'm assuming that's the high school, basically, and the other schools, it's $40,000 to $40,000 budget to budget. So you didn't put that increase in the budget yet, though?
No, we did not.
Okay. Unless you're not seeing the whole $40,000 this year, I don't know.
No, we at this point in time, we have not opened up that high school wide at this point. One of the things we needed to do this year, let's give an example for you, the auditorium. We needed to make sure that auditorium sound booth and the lighting, we had people that were trained. The last thing I want to do is to have an outside group come in, give them access to that multi-$100,000 sound booth and lighting booth, and let them have at it. It's a very complex electronic process, and we've actually, back in February, did training. So we had training both IT folks from the town, IT folks from Weathersfield Public Schools, as well as staff trained on how to utilize that board. So we've been pretty tight on giving open use at this point. However, it's interesting. One of the things we recently had, Mr. Hurley, was the senior dinner. Where we had members of the senior citizens here in Weathersfield come out for dinner, sponsored by National Honor Society, and then a showing of our spring production. And I think within 10 minutes of me being in the cafeteria, I had one of the gentlemen get up and ask if he could rent the cafeteria in September for card night. So it's certainly one of those things that's going to be used more and more.
Other questions from council? Thank you, of course, for your presentation. I know all the work that went into getting this budget before us. It's our first real good look at it, obviously. Michael, you mentioned some additional budget workshops, and as we go into April and the legislative body assumedly begins to tighten up some of these line item analysis that will impact us, we need to set some of that, I guess. So the easiest way, I assume through Matt, we can begin to look at calendar overlap and assume, because
sure.
I'm sure, speaking for council, we'd want to have at least one or two opportunities to sit with you as some of that narrative becomes more clear. And I know there's a lot of support in the community for this budget as it's presented, the work that was done to get it there, and I think the council understands that, of course. But I do think there's a large number of moving parts that the state is dictating at this point that will not become entirely clear. And frankly, I know there was some legislative action to try to allow municipalities to hold on the passage of their budget past their charter times. Ours is May 15th. It's safe to assume that the state's budget won't be clear by May 15th, but we have typically in the past stayed with our charter commitment, knowing that there may be some impacts. But with respect to that, I do appreciate if we could keep one or two budget workshop times available to us as we get closer and have some of these moving parts land. So, but I certainly thank the board for their work. We, you know, obviously 2.9 is a very appropriate and lean start. We always have to have deliberation and discussion, which we have had openly, I think, over the last several years, very productively with the current board, and we appreciate that. So rest assured, we look forward to having that discussion as we see some of the numbers. So
thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, everyone.
Thank you, everyone.
Thanks.
We have three public hearing items before regular public comment this evening. The three items are listed in our agenda. One is a certified resolution with respect to small cities program. A second is a resolution establishing small city grant reuse, and the final resolution establishing a fair housing policy. So before we go to regular comment, are there members of the community that wish to address any of those three hearing items this evening first? These are public hearing items that are available for the public to comment in advance of any other public discussion. Is anybody here this evening to discuss any of those three items, the resolution on small city grants, view use, or fair housing? Okay. Bob?
Good evening, Robert Young, 20 Copper Mill Road. I'm not aware of any of these because I didn't read the agenda. But on the other hand, all these grants come from somewhere. And they come from taxes that we send in to the state and the feds. They also come from borrowed money, something you folks like, borrowed money. And I really think we should turn grants down, Mayor. The economy, you've been taking them for years. And look what the state of Connecticut and the feds have for budget deficits, and it's all because of that. Well, it's not all, but that's a good portion of it. And I really think we should start turning these things down, and in all 169 towns across this state should be turning them down, because we're just burying ourselves. I know none of you realize that. But the rest of us, a lot of us, realize that. And I really think we should turn them down. Thank you.
Thank you, Bob. Anybody from the public wishing to speak on any of those three public hearing items? Second call. Yes.
Hi.
Yes, please come up and state your name and address, and feel free to speak on those items. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Peter Huckins from Community Consulting. I write community development block grants, and I'm writing the grant for the James Devlin renovations to James Devlin. Community development block grants are federal money. They're allocated to the states on a competitive basis, the Small Cities Program. They are used for housing, public service, housing rehab. And the grant that we're going after is a housing rehab grant to renovate, to make further renovations to James Devlin. That is a, it's a senior housing complex located on 60 Lancaster Road. It's a nonprofit, and it's for elderly and disabled persons. There are 50 units in the complex, and it provides an environment where residents can still live independently and still within a social network. Location of the community provides peace and quiet in an affordable and relaxing atmosphere for older generations, as our population is getting older and older these days. These types of complexes are becoming more and more useful to, as we get the aging, to last longer and longer. Most residents are either longtime residents of Wethersfield that can no longer live on their own, and they have moved to James Devlin to be near family and living in Wethersfield. It was constructed in 1979, and we've had previous block grants funded, which included new roofs, siding, gutters, downspouts, replacement windows, upgrade to fire alarm system, new flooring, kitchen, and bathroom upgrades, which we're doing right now with the 2015 grant, new Energy Star rated hot water heaters, and new entry doors with all lever action hardware. Funding for the 2017 Small Cities grant would address the remaining items on the capital needs assessment for James Devlin. The proposed work includes paving the parking lots and sidewalks, new baseboard heaters, new thermostats, interior doors for pantries, bathrooms, and hot water heaters with lever-action hardware, and new exterior doors. The parking area and sidewalks have become a hazard because of deterioration, which has caused tenants to fall and poses a barrier for those using walkers and wheelchairs. The other items to be renovated are now 39 years old and are showing their age. This activity will provide 100% direct benefit to the low-income persons that live there. There are currently 49 residents, which 38 are disabled. Residents of James Devlin Senior Housing Complex must be 62 years of age and be disabled and also meet HUD federal income guidelines. Renovations to James Devlin Complex will directly improve the living conditions of the elderly and disabled population in Wethersfield. These improvements show that the residents of the James Devlin complex are valued to the town, enhancing a feeling of community and equality among citizens. We also feel this project directly benefits the community by providing construction jobs for the unskilled, semi-skilled, and skilled workers. Housing rehabilitation projects provide numerous entry-level positions and provide stable employment to local small business contractors. Also, local retailers benefit from the purchase of supplies and materials. If you have any questions, the public hearing is a mechanism for citizens to provide input to the community and to the proposed application that's due April 13th to the Connecticut Department of Housing. So you get this opportunity, as one gentleman already stated, that he's opposed to grants. Actually, this might be the last year we have community development block grants, because in the federal 2018 budget, they are 100% eliminated. So this is an opportunity for maybe we get someone to say they support this, Everyone's going to be, if we live long enough, need a complex like this. And we need to keep these renovated and up to date for the safety and welfare of the residents and of the community of Wethersfield. If anyone would like to comment, please, you can do so at this time.
Thank you.
Thanks.
Okay, thank you very much.
Thank you. Jeff, you're going to read something?
Yeah, I have something to read into the minutes. Part of this grant, as Peter said, and Peter is our consultant on these projects, and he's handled three prior grants. He's done a great job for us. We have a 2015 Small Cities grant, which needs to be at least 50% expended by the time we apply for this one. So I need to read this into the record. 2015 Small Cities CDBG grant, Community Development Block grant. Within each unit at James Devlin, the 2015 Small Cities grant addressed kitchen renovations, including new flooring, cabinets and appliances, bathroom renovations, including new flooring, sinks, faucets, and tub glazing, new hot water heaters, as well as new entry and interior doors. The grant, including program income funds allocated for the project, is currently 98% expended. The budget period ends September 30th, 2017. In order for the town to apply for the 2017 funding round, the 2015 grant needed to be at least 50% expended. Thank you.
Thank you. So a last call for any opportunity for public comment on this grant application. Public comment. Okay. Seeing none, I'm going to declare that hearing closed. Thank you. We'll move into regular public comment. Public comment this evening from folks on any item of interest to me. Yes.
The formal public hearing on the budget April 17th. The people time you want to speak about it. The formal hearing is the 17th.
Right. Oh, yes. Okay. Okay. Heard that. Thank you. Yes. Yeah, you can leave.
Thanks. Hi, my name is Colleen Matatol. I live at 124 Wheeler Road. I'm the co-president of the Emerson Williams PTO, and I'm representing some of the Emerson families here today. If everyone from Emerson can wave or stand up. We have a good group of people here, and we're standing here. We're asking you to accept the Board of Education budget as it's proposed. This bare bones budget is asking for $0 for new initiatives, and I have a first grader. That's really disappointing, really disappointing. We can't even get our walls painted. We've been asking, and we just don't have money to paint the walls, and they're in bad shape. Some of them are embarrassing. We can't upgrade the building to make it look somewhat modern. Last year at a survey, several people described the exterior of our building to be prison-like looking. There are definitely some upgrades that need to be made, and it's a shame that we can't even factor that into a budget, and it wasn't factored in last year either. I implore you to take a walk through the schools before you vote on this budget. Really, if you haven't been in the schools, I'm happy to give you a tour of Emerson, and I'm sure all of the principals will too, and they can point out the things that are just really lacking, especially the walls. The budget reflects a 2.9% increase, and as Mr. Emmett explained, this really doesn't allow for anything new. And, you know, what's that saying about our children's future? It's really not something to be proud of. I'm disappointed that this budget increase doesn't bring anything new to our schools. We have a beautiful new high school, but all of our other schools are in rough shape and quite old. I'm also disappointed that this does not include tutors for the ELL. Our school system is missing out on educating some of these kids that are at a disadvantaged to begin with. And we don't even have the money to pay someone a vacant position. And that's just too bad. I know that we are lacking in the special ed teachers, and we are also have fewer tutors at the high school that we would like. So if the town council cuts this budget, what it's really doing is it's taking away from our children. The proposed increase isn't increasing anything except just factoring in the salaries and the benefits. So please don't cut this budget. Please accept it as it's been proposed. Thank you.
Thank you, Colleen. Yes.
Good evening. My name is Sharon Silbo. I live at 72 Dix Road in Weathersfield, obviously. I have a 10-year-old at Emerson in fifth grade. He is special education. And I have to say that we can't get any more bare bones with this budget. If you cut from 2.94%, what are we cutting? We're going to cut teachers. We have like the minimum amount of teachers that we need as it is. And I'm just hoping that you'll really consider 2.94 as bare as it can get. I mean, if we cut from that, I don't know where we go from there. So I just really want to urge you to consider passing that budget as it stands. Thank you.
Thank you. In the back, in red.
Stephanie DeCarli, 7 Monticello Drive. Hello, I'm here to speak about the turf at Catone Field. I've been a soccer player in town since mini kickers. I'll be entering my senior year of high school next year and sincerely hope that the town replaces the current field before this upcoming fall. I have missed my entire junior year and am still in physical therapy following my femoral ligament reconstruction surgery. That was from an injury I sustained during warm-ups just prior to our first varsity scrimmage. I planned to move during a give-and-go warm-up, and my foot didn't move, but my knee did. My kneecap ended up completely on the side of my left leg. It was so damaged, I wasn't able to have the surgery until I could rebuild the strength in my quadricep after being immobilized for several weeks. Many other speakers have spoken about the dangers of this out-of-date turf and injuries sustained through football. I'm here to tell you that as a soccer town, Weathersfield can't delay this any longer. Please get the turf installed before there are any more injuries and my senior year begins. I'm hopeful that after 6 months of rehabilitation, I can come back to play on a safe turf field this fall. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes, in the green.
Hi, I'm Autumn Struff, 24 Southwell Road, here in Weathersfield. We elected all of you to do amazing things for our town, schools, community, and most importantly, our children. Our family moved to Weathersfield 2 years ago from Manchester, where we believe that because of the higher taxes we paid to live in this town, the school necessities and needs would always be met without us having to worry about anything being taken away. Over the last 2 years, these worries haven't gone away, and this year I'm here to urge you to approve the superintendent's proposed budget as it is, representing a 2.94% increase. Our children need what they have in our schools at this time. Emerson Williams, that's where I'm representing tonight with the other parents that are here, as well as the whole community of Weathersfield and the children. We have an amazing elementary school because of the teachers, staff, and faculty that we have, and we all make do with what we have, which, with what the proposed budget is still the bare minimum. We have great statistical ratings because of the work that our teachers and staff have done with our children. If you don't approve the budget as the 2.494 increase, then that's going to increase class sizes because we're going to take away those teachers. And those children that are already falling behind are going to be lost, and we're not going to be able to find them. This proposed increase is the bare minimum, and I support the superintendent trying to be as responsible as he can be with this budget. Thank you for all the work that all of you have done. If you don't approve the budget, you're not only depriving our schools to excel, you're having a detrimental impact on each and every student in Wethersfield Public Schools. These students should be at the forefront of any decisions that you all make, as you all made promises to us when we voted for you. Please remember, if you put our schools at risk with budget implications, then our children are at risk to succeed. I appreciate your time listening tonight, and I can only hope that you envision the monumental successes you will be providing to the youth of Wethersfield with making the correct decision on approving the proposed budget as it is. Thank you.
Thank you. Yes.
Hi, my name is Amanda Roman, and I live at 686 Folly Brook Boulevard. I'm not going to be as, I'm sure, well-spoken as anyone else, but I can tell you that, like Autumn, I moved here from Manchester. I grew up there, and I've seen schools fall apart. And when my husband and I decided that we were ready to start a family, we moved out of Manchester into Wethersfield because of the schools. And I will say, I didn't think about this until Colleen mentioned it, but when I first walked in to Emerson Williams almost a year ago for my daughter's kindergarten orientation, I was taken aback. I did not anticipate that this was going to be the great school that I had expected because it was so run down. And so the carpet was so worn. I remember walking around thinking, was this the right decision to move my family here? And it absolutely was. The past year has been great. She's learned a lot. She used the word properly instead of correctly or right. She's flourished in your school systems. And I don't want to have to make another move for my family to find a better school system. I think the budget that Michael Emmett has proposed is responsible. It's lean. And I love living in Manchester. In the past 5 years, I feel like it's a community that I can be a part of. And I would hate to think that someday soon I might have to think about leaving it for a better school system. We moved here for that one purpose, to raise our family, to be part of a community. So I urge you all, please, take the budget proposal seriously. Thank you.
Yes.
Christy Salters Pedno, 15 Fairmont Street. I have a fourth grader and a first grader in the school system, and I can echo everything that's been said. We have great schools, but not because they have a lot of luxuries. They are lean and hardy schools. And certainly the physical condition of the schools needs improvement. My fourth grader is in a trailer that's been attached to Charles Wright School. He's learning a lot, but it gets really cold and or really hot. But I actually wanted to talk about something that often gets left out in these discussions because people talk about the Board of Education budget as spending, and I really think of the Board of Education budget as investment. Our schools are an economic driver for our town. We just had two people get up and talk about how they moved here because of our schools. They drive our property values. So I think that's so important to talk about. This is not just spending, and certainly this budget is incredibly responsible, but this is an investment in creating a virtuous cycle within our town. Thank you.
Thank you. Other public comment? So you appointed the right people to speak on your behalf, so you could reduce the number of speakers. That's okay. Yes, thank you. Please.
Good evening. My name is Jody Morrissey, 70 Linden Street. I, too, moved to Weathersfield 16 years ago. I lived actually just up the street in Rocky Hill for 15 years before that, because my husband and I wanted to live in a really good community with a good school system where we could raise our family. My daughter is in fifth grade at Emerson Williams. And I feel that the budget that the Board of Education has put together is also very lean and responsible. And while I am disappointed that there aren't increases for technology for bringing our students into the 21st century and beyond, that those kinds of things have to get cut for the basics. I am very proud to be part of a community that does pitch in and help when necessary. A number of years ago, there was no money to hire someone to paint our sign, the Emerson Williams school sign that sits out in front of the building in the circle. So I did it. And they grabbed some paint from wherever y'all keep your paint. And I went out there on my own time and sanded and painted the sign. And it still looks pretty good today, and it's been a couple of years. So, you know, that just kind of speaks to who we are as a community. And we are willing to chip in, but we can only do so much. And also, I know that my health care expenses have gone up. My contributions to my employer for my benefits, and they're hugely expensive. So I understand why such a large percentage of the budget is covering salaries and benefits. So, but we certainly don't want our children to suffer at all. We want them to go on and be good members of the community, and that's why I rearranged my plans so that I could be here tonight to show my child how important it is to be a member of the community, whether or not it's convenient or pleasant. But it's important. So thank you very much.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Connie DiGiacomo. I was here 2 weeks ago as a parent. Today I'm here with our Weathersfield Football Booster Club as the boosters here. So 270 Brimfield Road. So as I said, my name is Connie DiGiacomo, and I am the Weathersfield High School Booster Football Booster President, and I'm here with a few members of our board this evening to speak to you, not as parents, but as booster board folks. And we understand that you're working towards getting the replacement of the turf, and we thank you for your efforts and that commitment. And we look forward to getting that approval and working and with everyone and gaining an understanding of what that implementation plan would be. But what I would like to talk to you about tonight is to share a financial perspective of what the Weathersfield football boosters do for our football team and how it can directly impact the actual budget in certain instances related to sports funding. What we do as a board actually saves the school system money because we fund a lot of the activity, a lot of the needs of the team that are not covered by the budget. We are the largest booster board, a booster club in the high school. And in 2016, we had approximately 70 players and their families as members. And we raise funds through membership fees, sponsorships, fundraisers, as well as the concession stand income. 100% of the funds that we raise goes directly back to the team. Everything we raise goes for a particular need they might have, as well as in addition to certain funding for equipment that might not have been included in the original budget projections that Coach Campanella submits. We pay for camps for individuals that are not able to fund that themselves. Some jerseys, the football pants, as well as some training that the coaches need.
The concession sales at our Friday night games are approximately $5,500. That is what we net after all of our expenses. If we don't get the turf replaced and be able to have the games at our field, that would be direct impact to the team, and then it would limit the funding that we have for, it limits the funding we have for the team and the coach, and it could cost the town more money. And obviously that's the last thing we want to do when we're dealing with a very lean budget. So we just wanted to give you that financial perspective of the boosters and what we can do to help our football program. Thank you.
Thank you.
Other public comment this evening on any topic? Gus?
Good evening. Gus Colantonio, 16 Morrison Avenue. I saw the budget, you know, and it was okay, I guess. The only thing I've seen it now, year after year, year after year, everybody expresses basically how much we care for our kids, this and that. But yet, every time we do have an increase, most of the increases goes to teachers, salaries and pension and whatnot. I'm sorry, but I don't believe that basically the Board of Education really does care about our kids. I was doing my income tax. And obviously the income tax, you go by and this and that, and then I see the income of last year, the income of this year and whatnot, and it was exactly the same. I got the zero increase. I've been in this town for 43, 44 years now, and every year the taxes go up. My Social Security doesn't go up at all. And I'm also surprised or disappointed a little bit because, you know, and I agree, school is very important. You know, I'm disappointed basically when some of the parents say, come on, you know, the walls need to be painted. We spend millions of dollars and we do not have enough money to invest on painting these walls. Where do we put the money? Salaries again and pensions and whatever it is. I don't think it's fair. I asked before and I will ask her again. During these contractual obligations, who represents the taxpayer? I used to play soccer, and I agree with all of you guys. I think we should play soccer in a good field. Okay, I used to enjoy it, and it goes a long way. We complain about the little things, and yet, every time there is an increase, 3% increase on the budget every year goes like, says, how much more can I afford it? I don't get any money at all, just Social Security. You guys are driving me out of town. I don't think it's fun. On a different occasion, we had snow on Tuesday, and Tuesday night I worked outside a couple hours to clean the snow on the sidewalk. I was proud. I was tired. I was proud. You know, I'm getting older. The following day, I got up, and I saw 20, 30 feet of my sidewalk in front of the house, like, you know, was full of snow again. I got upset. I went out there. I said, wow. And right away, I said, maybe this is the town. When I went out there, I said, no, this time was not the town. I got so upset, I went in and I called the police. Pleasantly surprised. Within a few minutes, Officer Silva came by. And he says, Gus, we talked a few minutes here and there. He says, don't do anything. He says, what do you mean? Look, it's going to stay like this. I usually clean the sidewalk. Don't do anything. We're going to find out who did it. It took 2 days, and he made a lot of calls. But after 2 days, it got done. And I just wanted to say to Officer Silva, thank you very much, because, you know, you don't really see that kind of dedication from town employees. Thank you.
Thank you, Gus. Yes, of course, Lee.
Lee Seekers, 117 Wells Road. I'm all for the kids in school. I can remember going to school, but that's a long time ago. But there's some things that are important. Talk about helping one another go as a team. The town is important. But I can remember last fall being with the sidewalk inspector talking about some bad curb cut spots in town. And I said, some of these spots are faulty, but even worse in the winter because citizens don't really do the job of clearing the corner if they have a corner property. And I said to him, I said, the kids have no school like the football team, the basketball team, and they want community service, they need some exercise. Why can't we have those kids volunteer? Volunteer. This town, I was told, was a volunteer town. I volunteer a lot. And he told me, oh, forget about that. The child labor laws would kill us if we had kids help clean corners in the winter for snow. And I said to myself, that's not the way it should be. People should be able to volunteer. If they're football players or basketball players, or of course you can get injured. I guess injuries can happen anywhere. But that's not the point of there'll be limits to stuff. We're not trying to work you to death, or just like we're not trying to work the taxpayers to death with paying for bills. But enough about the sidewalks in the high school, but we got to all help one another in more ways than one. Now, it's been almost a year since Mike Turner resigned. I think it was April 1st. And I can remember him telling me at the last meeting in March, he's going back 2 years at least. They're talking about repairing and replacing two bus stops, one near CVS on the Session Highway, and one near opposite Stop and Shop on Townline Road. And they were being contracted out. As of more than a year and a half ago, the money was approved by the company handling this deal. And I said, how's it going to be done? Well, one town after another town. I can remember last March, and Mike retired April 1st. In March, Mike said, we're the next town on the line to get the bus stops built. Now it's almost a year later. I see no sign of a bus stop being built for pedestrians who have to get to work or to shop by CVS or by opposite Stop and Shop on Townline Road. Things dragging. That's one thing that never needs to be answered for, because after all, what should take so long? I know some owners didn't want things a certain way, but we have to do better with our, getting action done. And I just want to say, I understand the transportation contract has been up, and I'm sorry we missed a meeting this week with the Disabled Committee, the Dollar Ride Services Company, Curtin, and Social Services. What I do want to say is, we have to plan things a little differently in the future so more citizen input could actually take place in the future for the better understanding of the needs and desires and of the citizens and seniors and disabled who use the Dollar Ride service so things can be done hopefully a little bit better. Because we all want to make things improve. And things can improve more ways than one. It could be harder work. And it does not always have to be more money. Remember that. Things can improve without it being more money. It could just be a little harder work, a little harder, more intense concern, and in involvement. And I thank you.
Thank you, Lee. Pop.
Good evening, Robert Young, 20 Copper Mill Road. First of all, I would like to say that I, as a member of the public, was the only one that came up here tonight to ask you to vote no on those other refer to those other questions you had regarding the small city grants. The other person that came up here was a paid employee or a paid, he had a vested interest in it. And for him to stand here and ask the public to come up and support what he was doing says a lot about the program that you're going to vote on. And I still encourage you to vote no on it. And I encourage every town in the state of Connecticut to vote no on those grants, because it's costing us and costing us and costing us. In the newspaper, jobs report shows deficit. We lost 200 jobs in this last whole year in the state of Connecticut. We didn't gain anything. We spent a tremendous amount of money propping up a Ponzi scheme economy, and we lose 200 jobs. There's something wrong here, folks. Something drastically wrong. It says here, Connecticut Department of Labor Friday reported that Connecticut had its worst job growth in the last 7 years. That's the economy that you folks have given us. Mayor, you've been on here for how long? 4 years, and you've been a council member probably going back 10, 12 years. This is the economy that you folks have given us. There's no prosperity. It's all borrow and spend. Tax and spend. We have another article in the Hartford Courant. Student loan default rates are rising, and we've been hearing about that for a while. They're up 17%. It's getting worse. And a lot of these people out here are going to be getting student loans for their children. And how many of them are going to pay them off? How many are going to stick the government with it after we fund their education from K to 12, and then they go on to college and borrow more money, and can they get a job at the end of the day? Can you get a job at the end of the day or at the end of your career, your college career? There's a tremendous amount that can't. And then they default on these loans. And it's all because of an economy that's propped up poorly. Radio Shack closes 200 stores. Of course, that's in the country. And of course, there's voices, you know, about permit fees increasing for Second Amendment people who have guns, and renewal fees. And the state does nothing else but tax and tax and tax whatever they possibly can get. I'm not going to go through all of this. It's just, it becomes more mundane, but I will probably talk to you on the 15th of April, at the 17th of April. But what I also want to say is that I requested from the Board of Education what they call the, I asked for Catone Field revenues. Now, 6 years ago, 4 years ago, I came down to see the town manager, and he gave me information on revenues for Catone Field. And luckily I kept those papers, because when I asked the Board of Education what they had, they didn't have those, but they had their own. And of course, all it was entry after entry on an Excel spreadsheet of all kinds of gate funds and football receipts and all kinds of things that were not Catone Field, which is what I asked for. So I also asked where I could find the policies on it, which are on the BOE website, and they have a thing here called Use of Catone Field, number of pages regarding it. And one of them is about the fees. And it talks about that if anyone was to use the field, like a vendor that wanted to use it for a day or two or whatever, they would make a check payable to the town of Wethersfield and shall be maintained in the Catone Field maintenance account to be used for related costs. Well, I asked for the account for the Catone Field, and they obviously don't have one. Their own policy, they don't have one. And then when I did go through all of this, I found all kinds of entries, all kinds of people's names getting a check, all kinds of organizations, or not too many, but organizations and football games where cash was put in to the pot. But it's quite huge, and I'm still working on it. But I do see things in there that are very troublesome. Very troublesome, one, that we should have had a Catone Field maintenance account. That means one page or a file on all of Catone Field, revenues and expenditures. And the expenditures, of course, you would think wouldn't be too much, but it's loaded. It's loaded to the point where this is a fund that could be used, this commingled fund, where money comes from the town, money comes from different sources, and then they're buying a batter's box or some kind of thing, doing some construction work, things that don't belong there. If any of those expenses belong anywhere, it's on the books of the Board of Education. Now, you got to realize this is a sub-account. Sub-account we don't even know about. And when tonight, when somebody here asked about the revenues, and I'm glad someone did ask about revenues, we didn't really hear about the gate receipts from the superintendent. And that's something that I'm sure it's a very small piece of the entire pie, but it becomes underground kind of work. It doesn't surface anywhere. It stays within this sub-account. And then, of course, they're buying certain things. And I, the way I'm reading this, the superintendent is the one that controls the account, or the business manager. And I don't know who put this thing together originally. I mean, they captured a lot of information. It's unfortunate that they didn't read the policy beforehand. But I really think it needs really to be explored, because I believe you're talking about putting turf on the field. This money that came in should be paying for that field to be resurfaced, not going out and borrowing more money like the Board of Education likes to do. First of all, in 14 years ago, the taxpayers put up $1.2 million for that field. That's out the window. They had to pay it off. All that revenue that came in, I don't know how much is left, but it's obvious that nobody's saying we have X amount of dollars to put forward to buy this new turf. No one said that, because obviously it's, after I get done looking at it, I'll figure out how much you really should have. And they should pony up for it if they spent this money elsewhere. So this is a grave concern when the superintendent comes up here and gives you his budget and bypasses something like this that has problems. I think we all should be looking at this kind of problem, because if this little tiny problem exists, there's a lot of other problems that exist. And, you know, I believe that we need to cut back on spending. How many percent? 2.94% is, again, it's a high rate of increase. And especially, Mayor, when I look at some other costs. If I can find them here.
Bob, could I ask you to use your
I'll come back later, Mayor.
Thank you. I appreciate it.
I'll come back later, because I can't find it at this second.
We'll look forward
to it. But I have been looking at food costs. I've been looking at other kinds of costs that townside has been spending. And I think you better start cutting back. And I don't know how this got out of hand, but when I look at $15,000 being spent somewhere for food, I think you guys better better bring the hammer down on somebody, because this is crazy. Yeah, we do accept purchasing some food from one of the local little restaurants, but not $15,000. That's crazy. And we have a lot of other places to look. Thank you very much.
Thank you,
Bob. I'm sorry to take up so much of your time.
Thank you. George?
George A. Root, 956 Cloverdale Circle. I've thought a lot about what I want to say tonight, and it's going to be on a very different tone, a very different place. Most of you know that I'm 91 and a third years old. And I'm a World War II combat infantryman, recipient of a Bronze Star. And I don't usually brag about that, but it plays in with what I would want to say. I saw a lot of bad stuff in those 91 years as a young man during before the war in Europe. I saw a lot of bad stuff as a GI during the war in Europe. I saw a lot of bad stuff shortly after the war when I saw the effects of war in Europe. I had a chance to go behind a wall, you know, a famous wall that our president wants to build. I went through the Stasi wall, the wall that separated East Germany from West Germany, and spent about a week or two in East Germany and saw another dictatorship at work. You may want to know, why am I telling you this? I have never in my entire life been as concerned about my country as I am today. I'm not too worried about the schools department. That'll get done one way or the other. I'm not worried about the turf. It's going to happen. Do I think it's the best idea? Probably not, but be that as it may, it's going to happen. What I'd like to share with you comes from the heart, comes from concern. And I'm going to read just a few paragraphs from an article that was in the Hartford Courant, which is not necessarily my favorite paper these days, but it's, you know, I see it from time to time. And the headline reads, Malloy advises against alliance. Now, do you know what alliance he's advising against? Maybe you do, maybe you can't answer. I understand all of that. Anyway, Governor Malloy is reminding school and law enforcement of leaders that they don't have to enforce federal immigration laws. Homeland Security and how they should interact with agents from Immigration and Customs Enforcement were also addressed. And it's not a requirement that we do that. Am I a law and order candidate or a person? Yeah, in a way I am. Yeah, I kind of believe in it. But the article goes on to say and talk about the message that the governor sent to all of you, and maybe I'm only talking to part of you, but in reality, I'm talking to all of you, is loud and clear. Connecticut, and this is the governor speaking, Connecticut will not allow the Trump administration's racist and xenophobic actions to destroy our community. Goes on to say, Malloy, chairman of the Democratic Governors Association, has been a frequent critic of Trump's immigration policies, saying in his state of the state address last month or recently, regardless of whether your family settled in Connecticut 300 years ago or 3 days ago, you're welcome here. I settled in Wethersfield, Connecticut 52 years ago. and I don't plan to go anyplace. As a matter of fact, I got a permanent residence down in Old Wethersfield that I'll be going to pretty in a couple of years, probably. I think the message that he sent and shared with the community, the state at large, and was reinforced by what Stanford Superintendent Earl Kim said in a memo to the school districts, it's a stand that they take, whether popular or not. I think as much as it is a legal document, this advisory that the governor sent to the people, to the officials in the state of Connecticut. It's a symbolic thing, but it's important to hear what he has said. And it goes on and talk about Act, the Connecticut Trust Act of 2013, what you can do, what you can't do, and you guys got to do the homework yourself on it. You get the article. It was in the Current on, I don't know, I got the date here. It's in here somewhere. But again, I'll read very shortly. Law enforcement should not take action that is solely to enforce federal immigration law. Molloy and two of his commissioners wrote in the memo to the police chiefs. So the police chiefs are part and parcel of this, and he shared this with all of our elected officials, and I presume with the police chiefs. Now, I don't know where you guys stand. I stand corrected. Where our council stands, both ladies and gentlemen. But I have a little experience with an immigrant, a mother, and a little child. And as I read in that left-wing rag that some of you may think the New York Times is, but I find it a very informative paper. And it beats Fox News by one hell of a long way. ICE people, the acronym for Immigration Control, whatever the E stands for. It's an interesting acronym and tracks with sort of the KBG, the Stasi, and other things like that. I read recently where some of them were talking about the fun involved in going in at 4 o'clock in the morning and ripping families apart because somebody didn't do something, didn't keep their immigration papers up to snuff. So law-abiding citizens, not criminals necessarily, other people who are bad, and there are bad ones among all of us, be they citizens that are in this room or in town or wherever they may be. And it sounded to me, the things that I was hearing and reading and seeing as I watch all of this, and as I watch all of this, from the time this campaign started, this old brain kept saying to myself or saying to itself, I've got to be sorting out what I'm hearing. I've got to be sorting this out and thinking, what is this gentleman saying? And you don't have to be a rocket scientist to say it's dangerous. It reminded me of Europe before the war and how the Jews were scooped up at 4 o'clock in the morning. Families separated, torn apart. And my wife happened to have a half-Jewish cousin whose mother or grandmother ended up in one of these infamous places. I don't know, it was Auschwitz or maybe it was Warsaw. I don't know. But it was a bad scene. And when someone wants to demonize a segment of our population, I don't care what they are, Lutheran, Catholic, you know, Muslim, be whatever you may, it doesn't matter to me. It worries me no end. Going on, I'll skip a little bit, but anyway, somewhere in here, later on, it talks a little bit about the governor and this a former police chief in New Haven, somewhere down there, in Brantford, I guess it was, that he encouraged all state law enforcement agencies not to participate in his program of working with ICE. In other words, having somebody come in and going to the Emmett School there and saying, hey, I want to follow up on this guy, George Rue. Where'd he come from? I understand he's an illegal immigrant. And I may be because, although I was born in the United States, if I figure the time right, I think I was conceived in Canada. So maybe I snuck in. I don't know if that's the right way to... But in any event, it It is a scary set of circumstances that we find ourselves in. If local law enforcement agencies choose to enforce federal immigration law, it will undermine community safety. That's a statement. And I tend to agree that it's not going to enhance the opinion of our police officials or of our elected officials if they get involved in this program. However, he said it's important for the community and the folks in the trench. And I have spoken to this council a number of times lately where I have said to you, we as citizens, you, are the frontline soldiers in this war that keeps this country going. We're the frontline troops. And then there are generals and colonels and all kinds of higher-ups that, you know, kind of say, hey, do this, do that, and the next thing. But we're the troops. And it's incumbent on us to keep our elected officials, share with our elected officials our concerns. And these are not concerns that are only exclusively mine. The latest poll, I understand, I saw I guess it was in the Times or on TV or somewhere today, Trump's approval rating, I'm going to make sure I got this right, was something like 36% plummeting. His disapproval rating is somewhere up and around 56%, of which I'm part of. Believe me, I'll say that flat out to anybody who wants to hear it. And maybe you don't want to hear it. But in any event, to hear it from their elected officials, in other words, however, it's important for the community and the folks in the trenches to hear from their elected officials to have solidarity and not get involved in these kinds of things. That's the thrust of Malloy's release in the paper. And I don't usually go to the paper and pull it all out, you know, but I thought on balance as I summarized it, it conveys the thinking of this particular citizen. I've got a pile of stuff at home. I wanted to do this more formally and write a letter. And I'm busy. I got this little guy who keeps me very busy a lot. And so I say, oh, well, I'll get down to the town council. I was all set to come last time, but I fell asleep. and I just couldn't make it, you know. But anyway, I want to just share a few words from a letter that was a letter to the editor of the New York Times, probably some wild-eyed liberal from Woodbury, Minnesota. Oh, I don't know what kind of a town that is. It's probably more wild-eyed than Connecticut is. I don't know. He talks in terms of people who voted for Trump may not be racist, and they may have believed they themselves are not bigoted. But Mr. Trump used lies, racism, misogyny, xenophobia, and Islamophobia to sway voters. That's what this person wrote. And as you stop and think about it, and if you've been watching any of this, you don't have to be a rocket scientist or be an intellectual giant to be able to see that this is what he's done. Every Trump vote, well, they said every. I say many Trump voters. I don't know every. If sometimes what my wife says, everything is, you don't want to use that word. Many Trump voters claim to have voted for the right reasons. To those people, I say, the gentleman who wrote this or the lady who wrote this, I say, if you voted for the man who claimed that Mexican immigrants were rapists and murderers and you are complicit, when a Latino child is threatened with deportation or schoolmates. And this child that I was referring to that I know of happens to be of Latin background, not from Mexico, but Latin background. And I worry like crazy about this particular person because I know of it. If you voted for the man who appealed to white supremacists and who used language right out of the protocols of the Elders of Zion, then you are complicit when a racial epithet is scrawled on a schoolroom door or when a swastika is painted on a synagogue wall or a bunch of tombstones are turned over in some graveyard out in the Midwest somewhere. If you voted for the man who demonized Muslims, then you are complicit when a mosque is burned down. And then as I reflect back on my World War II experiences in Europe, oh, I didn't know any of these bad things would happen. How was I supposed to know? I live here in Wethersfield. I had the shields over my eyes. But in today's world, you can't not know what's happening. You just can't not know. You are responsible and complicit in everything this narcissistic, self-serving, authoritarian, willfully ignorant demagogue does. Yes, your motives in voting for Mr. Trump may have been beyond reproach, and that's possible. I can understand. I can understand where many people would be lured by the flowers and stuff he was hanging about. But do I expect my intellectual peers to fall for this? Hardly. In any event, now you have to live with your complicity. And that was a closing remark. And I thought I had this on my desk for months. And it spoke to me in ways that I don't think anybody here has had the opportunity to have ever seen. As it brought back experiences of that young man who went into the army as an innocent kid and came out as, well, I was still a kid. I couldn't vote even when I got out of the army, but a little bit more mature. And as I've gotten older, I think I've gotten a little wiser. I think. I won't say I have, but I think I have. I wanted to share this with you. And I know I debated long and hard about coming and doing this. I couldn't have put the fervor, the feelings that are part of me into a cold letter. And I never could do it on a Twitter. I don't know how to Twitter, but I couldn't say it in 140 characters anyway. So anyway, you have to put up with it. And I want to share. I have a file in my computer. It's called Why Sayings of all kinds of people. People you know, people you like, people you don't like, all kinds of people. And I went through it last night. And I picked out one that I thought was worthwhile sharing. And patriotism means to stand by the country. It does not mean to stand by the president or any other public official. Any of you, it doesn't mean any of that. Except to the degree which he himself or herself stands by the country. It is patriotic to support him insofar as he efficiently serves the country. It is unpatriotic and not to oppose him to the extent that by inefficiency or otherwise, he fails in his duty to stand by his country. And if one reads the paper, sees TV, watches TV, is just a little bit alert to what's going on, our country right now is in a state of chaos. In a state of chaos. With the buffoonery and the raving and the ranting, and this guy's got his finger on the button. I don't know how many of you people got sons that you may have to send off to war someday. But it's a very bad experience. It's a very dangerous pastime. And you really want to think whether or not, however you voted, whether you've done the right thing. But it's never too late to wake up and say, hey, maybe I made a mistake. And Mr. Trump, he don't know how to do that. With that, ladies and gentlemen, like it or not, George Rue has said what he has to say. Thank you for your time. I appreciate your patience. And I was glad I wasn't hammered down by the gavel after 5 minutes.
Back in the corner. Yes, thank you. I know you've been patiently waiting. Thank you. Yes.
Hi, I'm Casey White at 91 Center Street. and I wasn't able to be here at the beginning of the meeting, so I didn't hear everything people said. But first, I want to say it's cool to see babies and kids here. Go parents, that's really awesome. I'm in favor of the school budget. If anything, I wish that there were actually money for ongoing maintenance and repairs, because deferring that for a long time is, we're going to pay for it one way or another. And I don't know how long I live in Weathersfield, but I'm happy to pay for it, even though I might not see the end result of the investments. So I think the budget as it is now is the bare minimum we can do, and we should absolutely do it. I have a kindergartner at Hanmer, and she loves it. Part of the reason she loves it is that she has a small class, and she gets to interact with her teacher a lot. And I really appreciate that. I also want to say I think the Small Cities Program grant application is awesome. That's great. Let's get that money. And the fair housing policy is also wonderful. I think that is a wonderful legal redundancy to have those protections at a town level, and also have a point person in charge of coordinating with people who think they might have faced discrimination in their housing. So that's what I have to say tonight. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hi, I'm Jennifer Riley. This is my husband, Jim. Our daughter's doing homework in the hallway because she also supports the Board of Ed. Our son, PJ. We moved to Weathersfield last August because of the schools. We chose the Emerson Williams District because of the school. We support the Board of Ed. I'm a teacher. I've taught in a magnet school, and I now teach in a public school, so I can speak from both ends of it. We have to remember, if we don't provide the money to keep our schools great, the money will leave to magnet schools. And it's very expensive to send kids to magnet schools. You've got the kids in town, keep them here. You're doing a great job, keep doing a great job. And anything else?
Thank you, Town Council, for all your hard work. It's much appreciated.
So, PJ, say thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you for patiently waiting that whole time with your children. Yes.
That's pretty tough to follow. I'm Chris Vizina. I live at 387 Church Street. I'm an educator for almost 20 years, so I've seen more than my fair share of school budget battles, more than I care to remember. I'd like to imagine a day when school boards and superintendents could request and be granted funds that could actually dramatically move our schools forward rather than just keep us limping along like the current budget does. As we all know, schools are very expensive to run, and I guess part of the reason why is because teachers expect to be trained as expect to be paid as trained professionals like they are, instead of volunteering their time. It's always disappointing to hear from my neighbors and from the parents of the children that I teach that they resent paying teachers for their skills and their expertise. Teachers who spend their entire day with my children, I'm very happy to pay them competitive salaries because they spend the entire day with my children, and I want them to be the wonderful teachers that they are. I want them to stay in our schools and not leave for greener pastures. As my neighbor Christy said, our schools are also a strong economic driver in our community, and they are influencing the values of our homes. Charles Wright, the school that my two children attend, is in dire need of capital improvements which we keep putting off, and we see exactly, we've lived what happens when you put off capital improvements. We have a high school that we had to completely renovate. So we know exactly how that ends. This budget is the bare minimum, and I urge you all to accept it as is, and maybe next year we can try to do better. Thank you.
Thank you. Other public comment? No more public comment? Okay. Thank you. Thank you for all of your time. We'll move into council reports this evening. Is there council reports, Tony?
Start off with Capital Improvement Advisory Committee met and approved the roads to be done under the road maintenance program for the next fiscal year. Conservation Commission met and was given an update on the Fun Zone property and its effect on conservation. Economic Development Commission met and was given an update similar to what we received at the last council meeting on tourism and economic development in town. We received an update on all vacant properties in town as well as projects under construction. Budget and Finance Committee met last week. I'm sorry all the parents are leaving right now. I wish the board was staying to hear this. The Budget and Finance Committee met last Thursday night and they approved hiring the consultant to put together the bid specs for the artificial turf. They have agreed to get the funding. We've worked with the manager to start the project this June and not wait until next year to get it done. It's a safety issue and we want to take care of it. One of the things we said under that as a suggestion, and I'm sorry the board members aren't here to listen to it, you all came out in support of the board's budget tonight. I'd like you to turn around and go back to the board in support of us, in that we're making a suggestion that next year in the gate receipts at Catone that the board increase the fees by $1 per ticket and that dollar be put into a special escrow account on the town side to be used for the purchase of turf in the future. So it's a suggestion we've got, and I hope you parents stand behind us on that. We authorized the manager to hire a consultant, Luke McCoy, who will put together the bid specs for us, as well as oversee the project while it's being done. He was here the night that everybody talked about doing the field. He's an expert in the field. He sits on the turf board commission of the state, so he knows of all the turf people, so he's got an unbiased opinion, and he's going to be watching the project when it's done daily to make sure it's done correctly. They're going to be looking at the replacement of the fields. We're putting in a few options as well. Things like adding a cooling element to between the base and the turf so that in the summer, one of the complaints was that it's too hot for the kids when it's real hot, and this will keep it cool. So that's one of the options we're looking at to see what that costs. We've been asked to look at sewing into the field the markings for both football and soccer, the two major sports that are used. By doing that, the physical services staff will not have to go out and mark them for all the games, and so we can save efficiency and time on that, and those markings will last as long as the turf lasts for the field. So the only thing they'll have to mark will be for lacrosse and field hockey. We're looking at possibly adding the Weathersfield emblem in the center of the field and a few other things. These are all options that we're putting in. That's not going to say that they're all going to get done. We got to see what the bottom line price tag is before we decide. But, you know, we did hear your concerns, and the turf will go in this summer before the start of the next school year. So, parents, if you could go to the board and support the increase of $1 to come back to the town into a fund for the future purchase, I'd appreciate that. Thank you.
I just have a follow-up.
Go ahead, Mike.
I was at the meeting. I don't remember. I remember talking about the gate receipts. I don't remember ever saying I didn't support a dollar or anything. We never voted on that. So I'm not suggesting people go to the Board of Ed until we decide, you know, what the split should be. That's all. I don't think going down and forcing a dollar when we really haven't discussed it yet is a good idea. I think there will be some discussion, though, but I don't think we should rush into anything.
That's fine. Thank you for that clarification. Other council reports? Donna?
Attended the Shade Tree Commission meeting. They continue to meet and discuss declining trees and then looking at the Arbor Day ceremony, which will be April 29th at 9:30 on the Broad Street Green. And their planting schedule is out, and they're working on getting that prepared. And then I attended the Housing Authority meeting. They did not have a quorum, but they were having some discussion, and I was able to offer some suggestions related to that.
Thank you, Don. Any other council report? Steve?
I attended the building committee, a high school building committee meeting last Monday. On a positive note, there still remains $400,000, give or take, in the contingency. The punch list items are still being looked at, and some of the commissioning some of the issues that were mentioned, the drain and the showers. I know someone spoke about that at one of our last meetings. That is still being looked at to see what the source of that is and what the remedy is. Obviously, that will be addressed and has to be addressed. Another issue that has come up is the heating and cooling. The engineers are looking at that. There were a couple of rooms. Jim B, I believe, was simply too cold. There was a guidance office that had the opposite problem. It was running way too hot. So the engineers, the commissioning agent, are getting together and trying to solve that problem. Obviously, no one will sign off on that until obviously an expensive part of the project, and it's going to be looked at before it's signed off. So those are being looked at. And then the only other issue, the screening issue, I believe that's going to be before planning and zoning. Is that this week?
I think so.
This week.
Mm-hmm.
Tomorrow is planning and zoning, so they just simply discussed that what we had voted on last week will be before planning and zoning tomorrow night.
Thank you, Steve. Council comments? Done.
Just in light of the comment that was made in regards to the bus shelters, Jeff, do you have any update on where we are with the Crog bus shelters?
Yes. We've built several of them, and Derek can give us, we built three. The two locations that Lee's talking about, we're having difficulty with the property owner, particularly across the street at Stop and Shop. They don't want the bus shelter there. So we're trying to find an alternative location, but if you know the area, it's on a 30-degree slope?
Yeah.
It's pretty steep, so trying to find another area for that. And I don't know about the one at CVS. Do you have any information on that one?
That'll be done this
Okay, so.
Thank you.
Thanks, yeah,
but there are three done already.
Okay. Yeah.
Joey? I was gonna ask a question. In tandem to that, a lot of the trash bins, if you will, that accompany either a bench or a bus stop are like ridiculously in bad condition. Is there any money in the budget, or is there any plan to replace them, get rid of them?
We'll take a look at that. Some of them aren't ours. They're the bus company, so we'll see what we can do with that.
There's one specifically at the end of Wolcott, right before you turn to Knott. I know that's not particularly a stop, but that trash can has the city seal on it and is very worn, and just it doesn't even look like it could contain anything anymore.
Yep.
Other council comments? Tony?
I just want to commend Councilor Hurley on a great job for the St. Patrick's Day parade last week. Three of us did make it and brave the cold elements. And he kept us in spirits the whole time we were out there. I think there were more marchers than there were spectators.
No, not in those spirits.
Sorry, no, not that. Liquid kind. No.
Sorry to hear that, Mike.
I know. Right?
We could have used them, though, last week.
Yes.
Great job, Mike.
Thanks.
Any comments? Okay, just before we go into any agenda items, just a couple of comments about the board budget. Just a reminder to people, I know everybody left who, for the most part, and there were still some parents here. A couple of things, though. The April 17th budget hearing is an open budget hearing for all residents that will not only weigh in, obviously, on the board budget, which is a very large part of our appropriation, but also all other elements of our entire town budget that affects our residents. So just a reminder to people about that. I do appreciate that parents came out to speak to us about the board budget. That was our first look at the budget this evening, which is our first brush. I'm sure we'll have a couple of budget discussions before we get too much further. I do want to say, though, a couple of items that were referred to with respect to the facilities in our schools. I think all of us have either had children or have children now in the school system that are up at the dais, And, you know, I have to say I find it a little embarrassing that we're talking about painting walls. We have money in our line items. We appropriate a full appropriation for our budget for the schools. And how they administer those line items within the school budget facilities, I would tell you, and I'm not trying to cast dispersions toward any staff over at the Board of Education, but it isn't that we don't have paint in our budget. So I would urge parents who have concerns about the quality of the walls at Emerson Williams or Charles Wright or any of the others to raise that concern at the Board of Education. We don't make that line item appropriation, but you know, this is Weathersfield, and I would like to think that we could be a little bit prouder about the fact that our buildings don't have walls that need painting. And there is leftover money in capital improvement projects in the current budget this year that we've been raising that question. So there's a bit of a disconnect. And over the last 3 weeks, we've had parents come out here and talk to us about several items, the MBR, the deficit, the borrowed budget, painting in the walls, and the DECA program, which was held up for a while, which counselors at this dais expressed concern about. And again, I want to be careful. The Board of Education does great work. We support them. We have a lot of communication with the board, and we'll continue to have a lot of communication over the next 6 weeks with them. So I'm not being critical of them. But when parents hear certain pieces of information that comes out, and then they come out to the board, to the council rather, and they say, well, why can't we paint the walls over at Emerson Williams? And how can we allow this $4,000 program to go under during a $57 million budget? And, you know, those of us, and I'm speaking for myself now, but I suspect from conversations with the other members of the council that it's not unshared. It's a little irritating for us to hear it, to be honest with you. And I don't mean that as a negative toward anybody. I'm just saying that, you know, we labor over our budget. All of us here have been on council for several different years, some of us longer than others. We go through the line items. We support our schools. I had two daughters that went through the school system. You know, we'd like to be proud of our school system. And we're not sitting here saying, well, let's cut the paint. You know, we don't do that. We understand that. And the DECA program, for example, the MBR, the discussion about the field, which we've been working on, there's a lot more information than I think sometimes gets out to parents. So, you know, I know, for example, you're a teacher. Some of you have talked about being teachers. I couldn't have more respect for our teachers. I frankly think we underpay them, you know. But I'm pretty proud of our school system. I'm proud of what we've done over the last 15 years with our schools. We're ahead of, you know, if you follow the paper and you look at what's happening in towns around us, there's an awful lot of controversy between boards of education and council. We don't have that here. Everybody here is working for the betterment of Weathersfield, pretty proud of our community. And I think some of our parents that were here talked about volunteering. We have a huge amount of volunteerism in Weathersfield, which makes us a better town, I think, in a lot of ways, which makes me proud to serve, and we volunteer our time. But the final point, again, I'm reiterating, but you need to go back if you have those concerns about paint and the condition of the facilities. You know, somebody mentioned, our teacher mentioned it. I've forgotten your name. I apologize. But you talked about, you know, the proof is that we had to go do a major renovation at the high school. We've talked about facilities maintenance in our schools for years. And there is facility maintenance line items. And maybe it needs to be managed better, frankly. But I would start there if I was a parent, rather than saying, how can we have, you know, paint peeling in the walls in our schools? That's unacceptable. That should be raised in you know, in like kind. So we do work together. We do cooperate. But I am embarrassed to hear that. And I, as a mayor of this town, care about this community and care about the people that come out here and take the time. And there were some very nervous parents who've never spoken before. I appreciate that. That's hard to do. Get up and, you know, we're pretty friendly, but it's still pretty hard to do. So I beseech you to go back over the next 6 weeks and communicate those concerns to the board. We will certainly honor those respectful points, and board will communicate back to us what their plans are. But they do have a $57 million budget, and we're not chopping it up and saying, let's close our schools. We're working very hard to provide quality schools to make this town as great as it is. We should not be hearing that publicly, frankly. And that is not because the council is not giving enough money to the board, I can assure you. I don't know if anybody wants to add to that, but that's my feelings. Jody?
I was just going to say it might be helpful, too, to ask. When I was on the board 2 years ago, we put money aside in the budget to actually study and do a capital improvement plan for all the elementary schools, and it was supposed to be a 10-year outlook. I've yet to see it. I don't know if it ever got done. So it might be a good question to ask the next board meeting. I've sent an email to Mr. Emmett tonight just because it kind of came to my mind as we're sitting here talking about this. And, you know, we need to plan ahead. We need to start seeing where we're going to need those extra dollars or any dollars that we might be able to get to put aside for those things. So, you know, ask that too. That's important.
Thank you. Mike?
Yeah, and kind of to reiterate what you said, but go down a little different angle. I know we talked about this as a council and over, I don't know, probably the last several years, that it would be nice if the town just took over all the maintenance and the custodians and everything and let the schools just deal with education so they don't have to deal with that. And the parents could come to us then and say, you know, the schools are not in shape. I think the town should take ownership of the maintenance and the facilities and let the schools do the education. I know it works well in other towns, and I think it would be a good thing for our town that we have one maintenance department that does everything, and it might be more efficient.
Any other comments, thoughts?
Just to tag on to what Mike said, that's a big paradigm shift. So that's not something that's going to happen overnight. I agree that it's probably the right way to handle it. But again, it's a paradigm shift, and it's going to take time and reluctance on people who own that piece to give it up. And you're just moving it for the accountability piece, and the accounting piece.
And it could
other
be
than
efficient.
That, it's not going to change.
And it could be more efficient.
Yeah, absolutely.
There's definitely some duplication. It's not unlike what we talked about, shared services and regionalization in a sense. So it's certainly something we should be talking about. Okay, thank you. I know some of you prefer to wrap up and go. We don't have anything on the agenda. We're voting on that, probably address it in public, but you're welcome to stay and see the rest of our work this evening. Thank you for coming out. Jeff?
What has not been said?
Okay.
I just want to answer. Bob brings it up. The Catone Field Fund on the town side. We have one. We used it. We used to get revenues in when we leased the field to groups to come in and use the field. We have not leased the field since the building's been under construction for about 4 years. So we've not received revenue for 4 years, and all the money in the fund was spent towards the lights. So the fund balance on our Catone Field Fund is zero. So just put it out there in case there's any question. Now with the field, well, this summer the field's probably going to be down again because we're going to redo it. So next summer will probably be the first opportunity to have new groups on it.
I think I would like you to share, you talked with me earlier about getting all participants in at some point. Maybe just share that for the benefit of those that came for the field.
Right. As Councilmember Martino stated, we are moving forward with the replacement of the turf this summer. It's going to be a tight window. The actual build time or construction time is 3 weeks. August 15th, 13th, 15th is when the football team reports. We want to be done by then. We've hired, as Tony said, Castle Booze, Luke McCoy, to oversee the project. We're meeting with him tomorrow with staff to set up what we want to call stakeholder meetings between the coaches at the high school, the different rec leagues and rec programs, clubs, Richie Soccer, we'll have at least one meeting with all the groups to get input and then come up with a base bid and then a list of alternates for different things and then evaluate when the bids come back, the alternates we're looking for. One of the big, not questions, but one of the big changes on Catone Field will be the placement of the varsity girls softball team on what we call Little Catone. So that field will have to be, when the turf is redone, it would make sense to redo that turf consistent with a softball field. So that means different colored turf for, you know, the baselines and whatever painting we do and so forth and so on. So I think this not only is a, you know, redo the field, but an opportunity to make that field something special for that team who lost their field due to the renovation and the need for extra space on the site. So I think there's tremendous opportunity to really... this was the first class field 14 years ago. I think when we're finished in the fall or the late summer, this will be a very, very desirable and well done facility. But the first step is getting a stakeholder meeting put together, and we hope to have that in the next 10 days.
Thank you, Jeff. And not preemptively, we have to decide that as council on the budget. So we haven't jumped ahead. Just I know you made that point, and I think correctly, Mike, that we're anticipating that discussion as part of this our budget process, you know, because we're looking at different methodologies for the leasing, the first-year payments, which could be drawn from a couple of sources that are one-time, so we stay on track. But we haven't concluded that without full council input, for those of you who haven't been in budget finance. Okay. So left and nine, we're moving into council action. We're flying now.
Imagine that.
B1A, I think we have one appointment.
You do. It's on the dais.
Yep. Anthony, you can introduce.
I'm going to make a motion to approve Barbara Bellis to the Youth Advisory Board. She resides at 21 Round Hill Road from March 20th, 2017 to June 30th, 2020.
Second.
Thank you. We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. BC.
Motion to approve the certified resolution for the Town of Weathersfield Small Cities Program.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor and Council. This is, Cassie. And Peter's here this evening to answer any specific questions on the process, but this basically authorizes the staff to apply for the grant.
Thank you. Are there questions about this among council? I know all of you have a chance to see it in the packet, and then Peter was able to explain some of it. So, questions from council? Everybody good? Okay. I do want to mention in advance of these three that I got a letter from two residents, senior residents who live in these facilities, talking about how critical these are, these facilities in the Lexington area, for maintaining quality of life. So important, and the letter was, you know, breathtaking to read from someone who's been in that facility for over 20 years, how important it is. I know we have residents who don't think we should be accepting federal grant dollars and all of that. I think as those of us who are watching what's happening nationally, I believe some of these things are going to disappear, to echo Peter's point. We could take the process that we don't want to be participating in the national deficit, or even the state deficit for that matter. We'll be left on the sidelines so somebody else gets this money that's already been appropriated. We don't have influence on the appropriation, but we sure should be at the table rather than let it go out of our hands for such an important program. That's my speech. So we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Anybody opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. B1C, the second one.
Motion to approve the resolution establishing a small cities grant program income plan.
Second.
Motion and second. Again, same thing. I think everybody's read through these three. Any questions? All in favor?
Aye. Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? And finally, the third one.
Motion to approve the resolution establishing a fair housing policy for the Town of Weathersfield.
Second that.
We have a motion and second. Jeff, that's important for this criteria. This has to be.
Oh, absolutely. You
know, and this is a very long document that I don't know if the council had time to go through it, but I'm sure, Kathy, you've been involved with the creation of it, if I'm not mistaken.
Peter
has all of it. Okay. So this has all been done on behalf of these applications, which have to be done. So I thank you for the work on that, because it's obviously an extensive document.
And this is a restatement, basically, of the existing
formula. Yep.
Yep.
Okay. Any questions? We have a motion, a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you. We have no unfinished business. We'll move into 3A.
I'd like to make a motion to authorize the town clerk to apply for and accept a historic preservation grant for public document management.
Second.
We have a motion and a second. Jeff?
I'm going to turn this over to Dolores.
Thank you.
This grant allows us to take the all of our records and maintain them. We have records that go back to, obviously, 1633. And we put in for this is money we collect on land records that we put on in our files and we maintain in the vault. There is the preservation grant. We collect $3. One of it is coming back to us. The other two will go to the state library to help with their documents that they have to preserve. So we are, this year again, it's for $5,000. It's a targeted grant. In the past, when they've offered competitive grants that were up to $50,000, we had applied for those, and that's how we paid for our records maintenance room and all of that, things that are in our vault. So we, and the land use filing system that is upstairs in the engineering and building and all of that area for all the other records. So we do have to ask if you would let us apply again, and we do this every year, and that's what we're doing.
Thank you, Dolores. I know it's been a lot of work you've done over the years as our town clerk. Thank you for your efforts on that. I'm sure we have a lot of historic documents, of course, as our town. So any questions? Seeing none, motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Aye. Opposed? Any abstentions? Thank you. B, 3B.
Motion to approve the agreement between the town of Weathersfield and Weathersfield Housing Authority for a small cities program.
Second.
Motion and second. Jeff?
Yes, since the Housing Authority cannot be a direct grantee, we apply on their behalf and they become what is called a subrecipient. This agreement outlines the relationship in that agreement between the town and the Housing Authority. And it's, again, we did the same thing for the last grant.
Thank you. Any questions, staff?
No, it's just a very good process, and the relationship with the Housing Authority in the town, I think, has improved over the last several years, and they're really working hard to partner with each other to do the right thing for the residents in the town.
Thank you. I do want to mention, Donna, several members, including the chair, have expressed real appreciation for your liaison relationship with them. Shared it regularly.
Great group.
Yeah, they really like you a lot, too, and appreciate you put your time in there. It's a very important service for our town.
I have to compete, you know, with the Shade Tree Commission.
I know, it's tough.
We meet at the same time.
I know,
so
it's tough. Thank you, Donna. Do appreciate it. Any questions? We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. Motion passes. Okay. We have some bids. First one is for diesel fuel 4A.
Make a motion to award CRCOG bid number 654 to Dime Oil.
Second.
Motion and second. Jeff?
Thank you, Mr. Mayor, Council. This is diesel fuel bid through CROG. It's up a little bit, but still down from where it was a couple years ago. Our next year's budget that you'll see in a couple weeks reflects this amount per gallon, and this does include the Board of Ed for their buses.
Very good. Questions about this? Still hovering under two, thank goodness. So.
Yes.
Seeing none, motion and second. All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. We have a bid for Dial-A-Ride Services, 4B.
Motion to accept the proposal for Dial-A-Ride Services with Curtin Transportation.
Second.
Motion and second. I know you're here for that, Kathy. Thank you. Kathy, I had one question. I know you're coming up. When I looked at the bid comparisons, I was a little confused on, you know, obviously there's only two bidders, but they looked close, and the other one actually looked lower on one thing. Maybe you can take us through that. I know
sure.
Curtin is our existing vendor, but.
I believe you were referring to the RFP sheet.
Yes.
That had the different things. Be happy to. Just as a little quick background, the Dial-A-Ride Transportation bid comes up every 3 years. It's a three-year, we go out for a three-year request for proposals. And in the second and third year, we have so the first year is locked in. Second and third year, we negotiate a renewal.
And just that's what we're in now?
We're in the last year of the third year.
Okay, with Curtin.
With Curtin. And let's see. So when we did the RFP, we solicited the different quotes from the two companies that came in, and vendor number one, Curtin Motor Livery Services, their Dial-A-Ride basic service, which is what the town provides for our senior citizens and people with disabilities, that is limited to certain towns and goes Monday through Friday. And that's what we refer to as the basic service. So on that bid, you'll that quote for the RFP, you'll see that one company was at $12.54 a ride, and a ride is considered one way. So just to keep that in mind. Mm-hmm. And the other company was $12.50 a ride. So it's a difference of 4 cents. So if you were to multiply that out, and we used a number in the RFP of 13,500 rides for the year based on our past usage. And when you work it out, the vendor number two is lower by $540 a year. I believe that might be what you're referring to, or?
Yeah, again, I was trying to sift through it a little bit. But
yeah. And then the vendor number two showed if we ever wanted to look at it as an hourly rate instead of a per ride rate. It's easier to look at it per ride just based on where the different trips go to. And then option number one is we have the opportunity every year to apply to the state to get an expansion service for the Dial-A-Ride program. And that's a tri-town grant, tri-town application with Rocky Hill and Newington that we submit to the state. And in the past 3 years, we were fortunate to get it. We're waiting now to see if a grant application will be coming out. It comes out around this time. So we put it in the RFP to also lock in a price should we get that grant again. And that, as we all know with the state, we're not sure what is going on. So that we put that in there, and we serve as the administrator for the Tri-Town area. And that gives expanded service to other towns in our region for medical appointments. And the last one we also put in was the Therapeutic Recreation Service. They do social trips a couple of times a month, and we put that in again just to see what kind of a price we can get for those trips. So that's kind of looking at the tabulation form.
Okay. Questions? Don?
Yeah, I read through the materials. Thank you. And I know Lee was here at the last meeting and informed us that there was going to be a feedback session meeting. And I'm just curious to say, I mean, some of the materials kind of pointed in that direction, but if you could just kind of summarize how that meeting went. Were there a lot of people who came and spoke?
It snowed on Tuesday. The meeting was on Wednesday, so the meeting had to be canceled. So that was through the Advisory Committee for People with Disabilities. Every year they hold a meeting where we invite all the different transportation companies to come and invite all the seniors and the users to come and discuss how's the service been, what are your issues, and we have everybody there in the room. This one, that's why we held coming to council with this proposals, because we were waiting for that meeting.
Okay.
So we didn't have it. We asked, check with the advisory committee whether or not they wanted to reschedule, what they wanted to do. We didn't want to hold up too long on this because depending on the selection, there's a time for the vendor to have to get set up for our Dial-A-Ride service. So the advisory committee had a list of a couple of people that were going to take transportation to get to the meeting. So they contacted them to see what their concerns were and passed it on to us, to Erica and I, to review. We also gave Lee a call to find out what some of his concerns were, to make sure that we were trying to capture if there was anything out there that we needed to know about before we made a recommendation. So we did all that, so we did not have the meeting. Over the past 3 years, we've kept a log of complaints, for lack of a better word, for the service. And it's been of the people who have called our office to let us know what's going on and look at things that need to be looked at. We logged in 16 different issues over the 3 years. So that's really not too bad. And we try really hard to get the word out that, as you know, I'm going to complain to my friend about the service, but I'm not going to call and let people know. So we've been trying through the senior center, through the therapeutic rec programs, for people to give us a call. And one of the things we can say about Curtin, and one of the reasons we recommend them, is sure, do issues come up? Yes. We call them. They respond pretty promptly to what our issues are, and we get to move forward. Lee has given us some additional info that we're going to be talking with them again about, and so I anticipate that they're going to be as responsive then as they have been in the past. So that's what we were able to do, and unfortunately the meeting did not occur. And Lee brought up a good point that they schedule that meeting for March because you're trying to get past winter so you don't have to deal with weather. So maybe we have to look at the fall and see if maybe that's a good time to do it, just to get feedback a little earlier. And unfortunately, timing just didn't work out this way.
Thank you.
Other questions?
Kathy, who did we have before Curtin?
For the past 6 years, it's been Curtin. Prior to that, it was Logisticare, but they hired Ambassador to provide the actual transportation service, and at that time, Logisticare handled the reservations.
And were there issues back then? It was before my time on council, but I sort of remember, and I don't know if I'm thinking of a different provider or not.
As far as I'm aware, now I'm going back too, I know that that there were issues between reservations and getting the information to the transportation service. So there was a bit of a disconnect there. And there were service issues. And now I'm going back, it was not my department at that time, so I just know that just having heard about some of them. So I can't speak to them directly.
In any event, the last 6 years you've been happy with?
It's been, it's been very good. And Erica deals a lot with the day-to-day, if anything comes in or anything. And we've been pretty fortunate that, in a good way, we're not dealing with a lot of it. I don't know if...
Okay, no, good. That's accurate. And they're very responsive when we do have an issue that may arise. So
excellent.
Appreciate that.
Any questions? Thank you. Thanks for the work on it. Appreciate it. We have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Opposed? Abstentions?
Abstain. Thank
Abstain. Thanks, Mike.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Okay. For C, paving services bid.
Motion to increase the purchase order with General Paving for payment rehabilitation services by $375,000 for the spring paving program.
Second.
Been motion a second. I know Derek is here for that. How are you?
Good, thank you. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the council. I'm here tonight to discuss an increase to the PO for one of our contractors that does a lot of work with our paving program. As you know, we do two paving programs each year, one in the spring, one in the late summer. And as part of that work, we every year we hire a milling contractor and a paving contractor. We also have a contract with General Paving, who's been working in town for a number of years. The contract they're working under now was originally enacted in July 2014. It expires the end of June. At the time that was put out to bid, the engineering department had estimated quantities on what they expected the six paving programs over the three-year period would constitute, and that's how it was bid at the time. My understanding is they were the low bidder. I believe they were only the only bidder at the last contract. And what's happened is over the last five paving programs, we've expended the funds that were allocated to the contract for the work. The type of work they provide is they come in before we start our program, they come in and they do some drainage improvements, catch basin tops, and then the milling machines come through. Once they've milled, this contractor comes back in, they remove broken curbing, damaged curbing, broken paved aprons, and do that work. And then after the paving is done, they come back a third time afterwards and they replace aprons, they replace curbing as needed. So they're kind of an on-call contractor for us. They've been doing very good work for a number of years. They come in and out and work very closely with town staff and the contractors. So the request for the $375,000 tonight is, as I mentioned, we had expended the funds in the past five programs. Based on the cost of their work over the last 2.5 years of the contract, their work constitutes typically about 40 to 50% of the total cost of our paving program, very comparable to what the milling and paving cost usually is. So based on the cost that we've seen from them over the last 2.5 years, I'm looking for an increase for just to finish out this spring under this existing contract to get through the work that we have on the list here for the spring paving program.
And just want to add
something.
Please, and at the and we have talked to General about going forward into the fall and into next summer. They and Derek's been talking to them about a contract extension, and at this point, it's looking like they're willing to take 5% off each unit price for each item, as you can see in what we provided you, the original contract. So we'll probably bring that back next time for consideration of the council.
That's great. Very good. Questions for Derek or Jeff on this?
I just have a question. The memo that we were left, is that part of this discussion, or is that wait till next time?
No, he's prepared to talk about it.
Okay. I just had a question related to this. I read through it quickly. But based on the analysis that you did, Derek, and also looking at the comparison between the other communities and what they spent, I mean, there's, you know, we came out pretty high, and I'm wondering, from the analysis, what are the roads and conditions like in the other communities, if there's a way to compare, so that if we're putting $100,000 in this fund for crack sealing on a regular basis, and it sounds like we've been doing that for several years anyway, I think we raised it from 50 to 100, if I remember correctly. But I'm just looking at the outcomes from what other towns spend per linear mile and what we spend per linear mile, and wondering, is it better spent? And I get the point when VHB came and did their analysis, and the crack sealing can extend the life of roads so that you can keep them in a better condition for a longer period. But based on what the others are spending, should we look at reallocating some of that and going back and putting that back into the paving funds more specifically than the crack sealing?
Yeah, and that's something I did consider. That was that information was provided as more just to give you additional information. In talking with VHB and really looking at their last evaluation they had just done, approximately, as I noted, maybe about 70% of the roads in town fall into this category where they are at a good point for pavement maintenance to extend their lives. So just looking at the fact that approximately 70% of it is in that category, and talking with VHB, they felt very strongly that we are spending a good amount of money to try and extend the life of our roads as best we can, because to some extent we are still working our way through some backlog of roads that have very poor conditions. I think the 9% allocation of our 1.1, roughly we spend $1 million a year going to the crack sealing is beneficial in keeping those roads that are in that 70% category in that category as long as possible as we work through bringing the rest of the roads up in, as part of our program. So I think just looking at our indices that we have here in town and the road conditions, I'd say at this point, I think we're really in a good spot. I mean, I did know at the end, I'm still kind of getting familiar and getting comfortable with how the program's working and where it's most efficient. But at this time, I think I'm comfortable maintaining that amount. As you can see, I noted here, last year we did about 7 miles of roads, and that's about 7% of our roads. And we're spending about 9% of our funds on that. So I think it's a pretty good ratio right now for where we are. And that's something I'll evaluate as we go a little further and get more familiar with how the program's been operating to see if there maybe is a time when it makes sense to make an adjustment. But at this time, I wouldn't recommend it.
Okay. And maybe in the future when you're doing the expenditure assessment, I mean, to have just a little bit additional information, what's the benefit to them? So, I mean, comparing and looking at what Morris spends, I can't imagine. First off, it's not as large a community, so maybe it ends up being proportionate. But, just looking at the different communities that were analyzed, it just raised the question to me to ask. I think if I didn't see this, because I attended the VHB presentation, and that made perfect sense, but this drew questions. It's like, well, out of whack.
I don't think this recognizes how many roads they're doing, how many roads are paving, their overall road condition. it's just a straight division of roads times cost.
Yeah, I sent that.
But I don't think you can. I don't think you can really compare that between communities because there are such variations amongst the condition of the roads.
Sure.
So what I'm saying is, I'm not sure that this helped us.
Right.
It just raised a flag for me.
I think the first two columns are good. It's just that math on the last column.
Yep.
That's good information.
Other questions for Derek on the motion in front of us? Seeing none, we have a motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions? Thank you. We have minutes from March 6th.
Make a motion to approve the meeting minutes of March 6th, 2017.
Second.
Motion and a second. Any changes, additions? Seeing none. Motion to approve. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Abstentions?
Okay. Abstain.
Abstain. Thank you, Mike. But you just came in late.
That donut? That was one before that.
A little before that. Okay. Are you getting a little slippage? Okay. Okay. Before public comment, just a gentle reminder to our residents, public comment, this issue about the 5 minutes, as you know, I think some of you who've been veterans of public comment, both for the first and second, know I'm reticent about cutting anybody off after 5 minutes, been very liberal. It's gotten just a little bit abused, frankly, in the last couple of months. So just a very nice, professional, gentle reminder to our seasoned vets out there who we enjoy your commentary, but would ask if you'd be a little bit more sensitive to the 5 minutes, even six or seven. But we're drifting into 10, 12, 20, so just a gentle reminder, please. Public comment. George? And you know who you are.
And if I went over last time, that's the way it goes some days.
Well,
but I'll make
the,
it very.
You had the whole audience captivated.
Yeah,
though.
Yeah.
We weren't going to interrupt you.
I just thought a couple of minutes. You know, toward the end of my comments, I sort of forgot to emphasize the purpose. Why I wasn't just venting. I was trying to send, I believe, a very strong message to you. And just in case you didn't get it, I urge that this council adapt and listen to the guidance of Governor Malloy, and get back, because I have not seen, you know, like I said, I don't get the current, so I don't know what's, and from what people tell me, there's not an awful lot in the current about what's happening in Weathersfield, so, you know. But in any event, I think it should be the basis for some discussion. I think if there is discussion, I think you ought to get back to the community, and let the community know what the governor has suggested. And it was interesting, one of the ladies who spoke about the school, she spoke in one of the schools, they had a very, very high percentage of non-English speaking children. And we don't know whether they were all legal or illegal. And as far as I'm concerned, they're children, they're here, you leave them alone, unless they're murderers or rapists or something like that, but I don't think we got too many of those floating around, although some people seem to think we do. But in any event, I just wanted to share briefly, I gather that many communities and cities around the country are adopting this idea because it seems to make human sense. If we continue on the road we're going, I think our reputation throughout the world is really going to go to hell, and I think it's going to hell already. But I think it's going to only get worse. So I'd like to suggest that you give it some serious thought, get back to the community, and then share with the community what you think ought to be done, okay? I said you didn't know about conversation. So with that, ladies and gentlemen, I thank you for your time.
Thank you, George. Gus?
Good evening again, Gus Colantonio, 16 Morrison Avenue. I got 9 copies of intersectional sight distance right here, only 9. I count them, I guess, you know, there are more, but anyway, can you pass them around, please? But before I make a comment about the stop sign, I have to say that it's basically sad to see that everybody that spoke for the budget has kids in school, and and I go for the budget too, but I think the money is spent or it's going in the wrong places. I worked for this place for 37 years before I got laid off. And every 4 or 5 years, recession came down, and we went without a raise a year or two. Have we ever asked them to go without a raise sometimes? A couple million dollars could go a long way toward the turf, toward this, toward that, the painting. I think it would go a long way. But anyway, I think it's said that only the people that have kids in school come over. What I passed down right here, it's basically an intersectional sight distance, because not everybody understands what's going on. And I'm sorry that Derek just came right here. He could have spent a couple more minutes and stayed for the meeting too. But anyway, on the top it shows, you know, figure 11-2A, clear sight triangle, stop-controlled intersection. It shows that basically the clear sight triangle, it's measured from 15 feet. That's desirable. The town used 10. It's one thing. And obviously, as you see it, that's the angle or the triangle that you want to be able to see it to make it safe. Just underneath there is intersection sight distance. This is like, you know, a table. On one side says design speed, miles per hour. And by the way, this comes from the Connecticut State Highway Design Manual. 20 miles per hour, design speed, the intersection sight distance required, desirable, would be 225 feet for design speed of 20. For the design speed of 25, the passenger car intersection sight distance should be 280 feet. Now, as you can see it on Tifton, as it was done before, it's only 232 feet. I measure it 240. What I want to point out right here, though, that this is the design speed. What you design, it's basically about 5 or 10 miles above the posted speed. The posted speed on Morrison Avenue is 25. And it's good, 25 miles per hour, it requires 280 feet. We only can see 232 feet. And yet, nobody out there is willing to challenge, do we need a stop sign or not? Even my wife now, whenever she goes around, every stop sign in any place you go, if the stop sign, it's not, even four ways, it says four way, all way. If there is one stop sign in one direction and not the other, it says oncoming car doesn't stop, but not on Morrison Avenue. That's the only place. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Gus.
Good evening again. Robert Young, 20 Copper Mill Road. I still say, with all the money you folks spend, you should give Gus a sign on Morrison Avenue. It's surprising how people have come up here to talk about Catone Field being not safe and how quickly you operated to indebt us, because you don't have the money, to indebt us to put new turf on there. But for a guy that's asking politely for a stop sign for his neighborhood, you just fluff him off. Tonight, the town manager had mentioned, and I had mentioned, about Catone Field. And he said something to the effect that you spent all the money that was in the Catone Field maintenance account. And he mentioned that he bought lights. Well, if I remember correctly, the lights, there was 25,000 roughly, somewhere in the town of Wethersfield, that was donated by citizens. And then, of course, you got another $200,000, if I'm correct, from the state taxpayers, from the bond commission. More borrowed money. But what you had given me, Mr. Manager, is a bunch of payments. I mean, they added up to $30,000 or $40,000. So you should still have that money somewhere in a bank account, in the Catone maintenance account. And no, you don't. You blew it. You spent it.
What?
You spent it. You spent it like tonight Tony talked about the turf. Oh, let's consider putting something underneath there. Let's add some extra value to it, but we don't care how much we spend. Same idea. You had that in the account, and you spent the lights. Maybe you bought an extra bunch of light bulbs. I don't know what you did with the extra money, but the fact is, money is spent so fluid here. It just flows like water. The rest of us don't spend our money like that. It's tough paying taxes in this town. And suggesting a dollar per ticket. Good idea, Tony. Where were you 15 years ago? Because you probably could have had a good portion of the money you needed today. But no. This taxpayer got whacked with $1.2 million for that whole new turf field. We lost all the revenue that came in because it's not there anymore. It went out for people's money. The whole loads of names in that file that I got from the Board of Education that got money.
There's
This is one account.
No, on the there's one on the town side. There's one on the board side.
Don't they have one?
They do, but the one I'm sharing is the town side.
But I asked them for it, and they gave me commingled.
There you go.
Commingled. Terrible. No way to do business. And here we are. I'm going to go through it all. And I'm going to add up all those dollars that we can figure out that belong there. But you know, there's not one entry that says football, Catone Field. It just says F-ball or football with a date. It doesn't say, I don't know how many fields you have that have football, but there could be more than just one in town. No idea. Extremely put together. But it's incomplete, and unfortunately, the person who did it probably didn't have proper instructions. But the fact is, we need to go through that. And going forward, you need to have real accounting done on any of this money. I don't see in the policy how they collect money at the gate, and there's a process where someone counts the money, another person counts the money, and does the bank book, or does the bank receipt, and another person takes it to the bank, and then someone validates it. I don't see anything in the policy. What you got is people doing whatever they want to do, and who knows what doesn't make it to the bank. It's something to think about, folks. You know, cash is fluid. Cash is untraceable. And you may have some problems. We do. We citizens have problems with this whole thing. Unfortunately, our leaders haven't done anything to protect us on that cash. And someone's got to take a hold on it. And I've been complaining about this for some time now, and it's only because I once in a while threw a question at the BOE, and finally something popped up that I grabbed that meant something. And I thought the manager had all of that under his control right up till now. Obviously you don't, because they had it. And they did a damn poor job of it, and we're paying them extremely high money to take care of this, and look at the mess we're going to have. I will meet with the town business manager, the BOE business manager, and we're going to go through this. But thank you very much. I'm sure I have more things I'd like to say, but it's late.
Thank you, Bob.
Good night.
I'm sorry I didn't see you before. Thank you.
Hi,
Hi, Colleen Matatal, 124 Wheeler Road. I just wanted to reiterate and address some of the comments that were made regarding some of the improvements needed to be made to the schools. I have already brought it up to the Board of Ed that there seems to be extra money, and I will look into that. So thank you for this somewhat fragmented dialogue, but thank you. But I do want you to still, it wasn't just about painting the walls. What it is we are asking for an increase, but it's not actually doing anything extra for these kids. It's just providing the what we're providing year over year. It's providing money for the salaries. It's providing the benefits. I know there's some weird healthcare finances that are sort of wishy-washy, but well, whatever, sorry. I do want to address the fact that we haven't upgraded the technology and we're not planning to upgrade technology again. I mean, this day and age, a cell phone is out of date in 2 years, and this is what our kids are learning on. It's disappointing that we're not making these upgrades for our kids, for the schools, for our town's future. And I also want to address the fact that while the issue of capital improvements may or may not have money, the schools are old and the class sizes are already big. If there are cuts made, that means that the class sizes may even get bigger. As of now, classrooms in Emerson, they don't even have room in their classrooms for their backpacks. Their backpacks go in the hall because the classes are just packed with tables and chairs and desks for all of these kids that are packed into these 25 kids in a second grade classroom. It's obscene. And if we cut that, if we cut staff, it would just make it bigger. And that just means fewer minutes that our teachers are spending individually with our children. So please don't make any cuts to that budget, because it is going to affect our children and not just painting the walls. Thank you.
Colleen, I don't normally engage, but I want to on this. First of all, I know you're an Emerson Williams mom. You have two children in Emerson, or one?
I have two children. One is at Emerson.
And the other is where?
Little.
Little, not there yet.
No. Nope.
Okay, and how long have you been in Wethersfield?
10 years.
10 years. And you're, is it a son or a daughter in Emerson right now?
Son.
In what grade?
First.
Okay. So you're relatively new to the school system in terms of your child being in our district.
Yes.
As far as, okay. So if you don't mind indulging me for a minute, and I appreciate that you've stayed for a long time. Let me first talk about the technology one. Okay. There is a reference in the board proposal that says we're not quite at 1-1 yet on the district with respect to technology. But if I'm not mistaken, and there are other members of the council, including Jody, who was on the board, we have made significant investment in technology over the last 7 years in the district, and we're getting close to 1-1. Keith Raffanello, who is our director of technology services for the district, who's been with us, I think, about 4 or 5 years, and we just combined some shared services between the town and the board to ensure that we're streamlining the expense on staff side so that money can be spent on equipment and laptops and smart boards and all the kinds of things. And the high school was pulled out from that process during the renovation, and I'm sure we spent well over $1 million for technology at the high school separately. Yes. But we also have appropriated several $100,000 every year in the last 7 years, unless I've missed something. Jody, you might be able to weigh in here, but we haven't hit 1-1 yet. But it isn't because we have been making those appropriations. We have. And I certainly agree that technology should be an area that we should not cut when you look at. And again, I want to remind you, we don't make the line item appropriation. We will make some deliberation during the budget process with parent input and, of course, the board about where appropriations, you know, are going to look when they land. But the individual line item determinations are being managed and done by the board with our consultation. We're weighing in, we're paying attention, and we spend the time on it. And you know that, so I want to make sure it's clear that we certainly have heard that message and have paid a lot of attention to technology being a very important part of what we're doing in the district. We know to stay progressive with competing school systems. That's absolutely paramount. And there's no question, all of the data that I've ever read since I've sat on council for almost 12 years is that the school system is the number one driver for determining quality of life in a community. And Weathersfield is right there. We're not quite Simsbury or Avon, but we're darn good. And I think we compete with the best of those around us in what they call our DIRG. But so I think we're doing fine there. But I do want to share also one last point. I appreciate you letting me do this. But we're going in, and I shared this last meeting. The state obviously is putting a wet blanket over the whole community, not just Weathersfield, but all our municipalities. Right. And we're struggling with, as we go into budget deliberations, and there's nine of us here that are going to beat through this thing line by line over the next 6 weeks. But we're not going to have complete clarity on what it means for Weathersfield in terms of the appropriation that comes to us. And state dollars are an important part of what determine what our budget looks like at the end of the day. And it means a lot to me. I kid a little bit about George and Bob and these guys that have been here and been taxpayer conscious. But when we make a decision about our mill rate, and we're starting to approach $40 in Weathersfield, and I was looking at mill rates across the state last week, we're on the upper end of that. Now, there's a lot of reasons for that. We provide a lot of services that a lot of communities don't provide. Probably better quality, I think. You know, if you watch snow plowing, and I think we do better than most. I drove from Rocky Hill to Newington to Weathersfield during a storm last week. We were way ahead, and then we had a lot of complaints because it was a tough storm. But so the point I'm making is that we have to make those decisions about our tax rate, and we're doing that a little bit in the dark this year. And I've spoken with Bobby as our board chair, who I have great respect for, that we need to be a little careful going into this deliberation. I think they've done a very good job as an introductory concept and starting with a starting point at 2.9, which is very reasonable. I was on council when board appropriation requests were 8, 9, 10%. I mean, I think Mike Emmett knows we can't get there right now in this environment, but it's partly and probably a lot driven by the economy locally that we need to be very careful. So rest assured, and I think you can communicate back to parents in Emerson Williams, and I hope beyond that, Charles Wright and Hamner and all of our schools, that this council very much appreciates the parent input on what we're going to be doing in the next 6 weeks, and we're attentive to all the points that you made, Colleen. I think you're spot on about the concerns and the interest, and I appreciate parents that come out, and they do drive our decision-making. Make no mistake. Parent input influences what we do, but in the same respect, a lot of our seniors and other residents who come out and say, okay, and by the way, many, many seniors have supported our school system for decades. Mm-hmm. Been the first in line to say, spend the money. My kids have gone through the school, but they respect that Weathersfield had a great school system for their kids. So I appreciate if you can be a bit of an ambassador on that. I saw the email from the principal from Emerson Williams that it, you know, supported getting parents out. But you don't need to be angry. You need to be, I don't mean you personally, because that was one of the words in there. You know, we have to have a voice, and we got to be angry, and we got to get out there. We're not looking for that. The council doesn't need angry parents. We appreciate, many of us have or been parents. So getting that communication out and continuing to understand what we're grappling with, and that we're Weathersfield residents paying tax bills like everybody else, and we want to make right decisions. Right. We want to do that thoughtfully. So I appreciate that you let me weigh in on a couple of those things. But I think there's a little bit of a disconnect sometimes between what's being told out there, what parents are hearing, and kind of frankly, from my perspective, having done this for 12 years, what's really going on. And that disconnect needs to be closed so that we're having intelligent decision-making, that parents can appreciate that if we say, well, you know, we got to whittle this back because we may get $1 million cut in ECS. And that just doesn't, you know, right. That's going to be painful. And we have to do that on our part with respect to everybody else as well. So, anyway, appreciate that you took the time to listen to that. I'm sure I've taken too much time tonight overall, but this is a very important topic for us as a community and very important topic for us as a council. There's no other decision we weigh in on more thoughtfully with more deliberation and, frankly, more challenge as we go through. So thank you.
Well, I think one of the benefits of having people here is hearing what you're doing. Mm. So it is a fragmented dialogue because we are now hearing what you're saying and not just what the Board of Ed is saying. So I agree with you. I think it's worth to listen to.
Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much. And thank you for taking time tonight. Anything else? Oh, nice job, Joe. Second? Anybody? All in favor?
Aye.
Aye. Thank you.
Okay, so this is totally.
Our meetings are getting longer.